To the 24th meeting in 2015 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. As always, ask members to switch off mobile phones. I can inform the committee that Richard Baker has rejoined the committee in place of Margaret McCulloch, but he has sent his apologies to this meeting. And I welcome James Kelly to this meeting today in his capacity as a substitute. Thank you. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. It's proposed the committee takes items 8 and 9 in private. Item 8 and 9 will allow the committee to consider the evidence today which we're going to receive today on the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1994, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Amendment Order Draft, and on the Succession Scotland Bill, which we're just about to turn to. Does the committee agree to take items 8 and 9 in private, please?
Yes.
Thank you. So, agenda item two is the Succession Scotland Bill, and it's an opportunity to take oral evidence on that bill. We have two panels, the first being Scottish Government and secondly the Scottish Law Commission on the bill. And I welcome from the Scottish Government Jill Clark, the team leader, Civil Law Reform Unit, Francis MacQueen, Policy Officer, Civil Law Reform Unit, Kathryn MacGregor, who's a solicitor in the Constitutional and Civil Law Department, and Ros Wood, who is a solicitor in the Constitutional and Civil Law Department as well. So welcome, ladies. We have a few questions for you. And at this point, I have to find the appropriate piece of paper and ask John Mason whether he will begin, please.
Right, thanks, convener. Good morning and welcome to the committee. I think the first question I have is, given that there are two pieces of legislation on succession around at the moment, are you comfortable that there's not going to be confusion amongst practitioners and members of the public, the fact that we're doing the both? And following on from that, then, would you think that we need to consolidate the law at some stage?
Okay, I could set out a little bit of the background, perhaps, to why we've taken the approach of two separate work streams. I think I explained previously when we met the other week that the 2009 report is very large, it's substantive, and we know from some very early consultation that some of the recommendations, particularly around disinheritance, attracted polarised views, so we knew we'd have to do a lot more work on that, different consultation, etc. But there were many aspects of that report which were uncontentious by comparison, and we considered that they were very worthy of progressing at an early opportunity. And so that's why we've got this bill and we're consulting on the other bill. And progressing the recommendations in this way was to make the work more manageable, but also ensured that the provisions that are in this bill weren't unduly delayed. I think there is the potential for confusion, which was why we were quite keen from the outset to keep signalling what we were doing. So in the consultation for this bill, we set out that we would be taking a second work stream forward, and in the consultation for that bill, we've done the same thing. And in terms of timing, we were also anxious to ensure that while this bill was being considered by the Parliament, that the other consultation was in the public domain, so it became clear as to the demarcation between the two and how they would fit together. In terms of consolidation, that's probably a question for further down the line, should we have a future bill, and that will be a matter for the next Scottish Government, but I think it's at that point that we need to consider whether we wanted to consolidate or look at the landscape of succession law at that point, and that's probably just a little bit premature at this time.
Okay, fair enough. I'll just keep going through, convener.
Please do.
Yep. An issue that was raised is the Law Society's view that the bill should only be able to be amended by primary legislation. I wonder if you have a view on that.
We think there's good reasons why we shouldn't only be able to amend the law by primary legislation, but my colleague Ros will respond more fully on that.
We don't agree that the bill requires to be amended. If the bill requires to be amended, it should only be done by primary legislation. The powers to modify the Act contained in Section 25 are in keeping with the powers that are normally considered appropriate, and this is in case there's a need for fine-tuning, just to ensure the workability of the bill. It would be unfortunate if any element of fine-tuning to ensure workability was not able to be taken forward on the basis that you needed primary legislation. And I would just say that there's appropriate constraints on the power to amend the Act by subordinate legislation. It can be it can only be used to give full effect to the Act, so if you were to make more substantive changes to the Act, that would need to be by primary legislation. And in addition to that, I think the Law Society's concern was that practitioners might not pick up on the change in subordinate legislation, and I think our view would be that as a matter of course, practitioners, as part of their professional responsibilities to advise on the law, the most up-to-date version. So we think that they would pick up on that, and also the Scottish Government would likely publicise any powers that were particularly relevant, any use of the power that was particularly relevant for practitioners.
So your key argument is that there's really no reason to make an exception to this bill compared to other legislation?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, fair enough. Thirdly, the question has also been raised of this bill having any retrospective effect. And I think that's to do, as I understand it, with the dates that things would become applicable. Is that an issue?
We're going to deal with the application of the provisions by way of a commencement order. And generally, there's no intention to make any of the provisions retrospective. But again, I think Ros can go into some of the detail of that.
Yes, the Scottish Law Commission recommended that the provisions apply in relation to deaths occurring on or after commencement, but they recommended that Section 6, 7, 8, 19 and 20 of the bill should apply to documents executed on or after commencement. So their application, the Scottish Government is content with their proposed application, other than in respect of Section 5. So Section 5, in terms of what it does, under the current law, a will which is revoked by a subsequent will revive if the subsequent will itself is revoked. So Section 5 changes that position, it reverses it, so that an earlier will no longer revive. So in order, the Scottish Law Commission recommended that Section 5 should apply in relation to all deaths occurring after commencement, irrespective of when the revocation takes place. However, the Scottish Government are of the view that it should only apply in respect of wills revoked after commencement, and this is so that where a person revoked their will on the basis that their old will would revive, that old will is not invalidated with the introduction of the bill. And moving forward, a person who revokes their will after the bill has come into force does so on the understanding that their old will does not apply unless they re-execute it. So that's the only change in application that we're recommending.
I just wondered, and we'll come to this general subject later, in relation to simultaneous death or uncertainty of order of death, where one party to that simultaneity or uncertainty has a document written before and therefore not captured by the new law, and the other has one that's written after, whether that has any difficulties that arise in those circumstances. I can't imagine what they might be, but I think I would like to hear your answer.
I think that on the basis that they're both treated as having failed to survive, I think really what we're seeing here is that the effect of will of each person's will to the other has no effect. So I don't think that question would really arise. It would be headed off at the pass, if you will, because the nature of the provision is that where you both die at the same time, it's as if you never made any will in respect of the other.
Right. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, John. Anything
else? And the other point would be, I mean, I accept that you made the point already that practitioners and other stakeholders are often should be up to speed with what's going on at this committee and within Parliament. I just wonder about members of the public, though, that perhaps do not follow this committee with avid attention. You know, are there plans, assuming the bill was passed, to really communicate this and get this out into the wider public domain?
I mean, as you say, I think we're quite comfortable that the legal profession have been engaged in this process through consultation and with the committee as the bill progresses, so they'll be kept up to speed. But I think there is an issue about the public, but it's probably worth just putting it into a little bit of context in terms of, you know, many of the circumstances outlined in the bill will occur infrequently, and some of them even very rarely, and the numbers of public that they will actually affect will be small, and that's not a reason not to disseminate anything. But also lots of the situations, say around forfeiture or rectifying a will, would involve a court process, so the legal profession would inevitably be involved anyway and would have that knowledge. But what we have been thinking is that we do have a very useful and well-used publication which we supply free to hospitals, hospices, public, Citizens Advice Bureau, etc. It's called What to Do After a Death in Scotland, and it outlines the main legal provisions, and we're certainly going to be looking at that. There isn't much in it at this point about these particular provisions, but we're going to look and see if there's something that we could add into that, which at the very least would signpost some of these changes. And we've also got a website on succession which we'll be updating, and again we're trying to think of something that is accessible and easy to understand as opposed to perhaps the bill.
I think there's been an argument already that this bill brings the law more into line with what the public might have naturally expected. So from that point of view, I guess you might even need to explain it less than the present situation.
Yes. Ignorance is a wonderful thing, you might think, and we should leave it unsettled. But I think we just need to ensure that people are clear where there needs to be clarity. And, you know, whilst maybe in the future there'll be a much bigger public dissemination if we do you know, end up changing the fundamentals of succession, you know, this can also be re-highlighted at that point.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay, John Scott, I think, on the effects of divorce.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning. And I want to turn to the issue of guardianship and ask you what the policy rationale is for including guardianship in the scope of Section 1, and whether you agree that with the Law Society that there's a potential for drawbacks to this approach.
Yes, so Section 1 gives effect to Recommendation 52 of the report, and under Section 1, if a testator is, as you say, if a testator's marriage is terminated, testamentary provision in favour of the former spouse is effectively revoked, and that includes any appointment. So one of the concerns of the Law Society was that, as you say, a guardian would, where guardianship was conferred on an ex-spouse, that would fall. And I think that the policy rationale for this is that we did consider whether or not, with policy colleagues, whether or not this should be there should be an exception, but on the basis that where a guardian can be appointed by court process as well, there would be nothing to stop them going to the court and asking to be appointed afresh. In addition to this, the testator, and probably more importantly, the testator can make provision in their will to say, to override this presumption, and where they don't make that presumption, make that provision, we thought it was a fair, we think that it has to be assumed that the testator was not of the intention that the former spouse should be appointed. So that was the policy rationale for that.
So by omission, you, there's an implication by omission.
Yeah.
How long would the process take if had to go through courts for guardianship?
I have to say that I don't actually know that. I would propose to write to the committee on that to find out exactly how long it would take.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Maybe add just in respect of this, just in terms of application.
Sorry?
If we could maybe just add just in terms of application, it would only be the case where one of the parents has accepted a child or children as part of the family and does not have parental rights and responsibilities. So we don't imagine that it would be a common occurrence for an ex-spouse necessarily not to have parental rights and responsibilities over the children that are within the family, although, as we as has been noted, it could arise.
Observe on behalf of the committee that, of course, the fact that something isn't very common doesn't mean we need to get the law. Don't need to get the law right. It doesn't matter if there's only one case, even if we're not sure whether it's going to arise. We still need to make sure the law says what we think it should say.
Perhaps it's referring back to my colleague's comments then about the fact that the policy is that it should be the testator's intentions that are given effect to in respect of that section.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And can I also refer you to Trustbar's evidence to the committee, section 1.1d, where marriage or civil partnership ends, that whether you think there is merit in Trustbar's suggestion that section 1 should operate at the point when the marriage or civil partnership ends instead of at the point when the testator dies?
I think that the SLC recommended at section 48 of their report that section 1 should only apply where the deceased is domiciled in Scotland. And as you say, section 1.1d gives effect to this. The Scottish Government don't agree that the testator should require to have been domiciled in Scotland at the time of the divorce or dissolution or annulment in order for that section to apply. We agree with the Law Commission recommendation that in order to provide an appropriate link to Scotland, the rule in section 1 should apply where the testator dies in Scotland, regardless of where the termination took place. And the reason we think that is because it would produce anomalous results. So if you were to require the testator to be domiciled in Scotland at the date of termination rather than at the date of death, it would mean that a person of Scottish domicile whose estate falls to be distributed according to Scots law, if they got divorced in France for some reason, the Scots law wouldn't apply to them. And we think that would be an undesirable result. I think ultimately the view is that Scots law of succession should apply to those who die in Scotland.
Right. Well, you're aware of the concerns. They're certainly convoluted. Right, thanks very much.
I think that takes you over to page 6, actually, John, of our notes.
Thank you very much.
I think that's okay. And, please.
And the question that I'm now invited to ask you is whether you think there is merit in Trustbar's view that the protection for people acquiring property in good faith, that section 2.4, is unnecessary because property subject to a special destination passes automatically without any need for an executor.
Yes, so Trustbar have submitted that a third-party purchaser could never purchase property in good faith because they would always be aware of the survivorship, the special destination in the property title. And we would submit that section isn't really to deal with that situation. There are situations where a third party could purchase property in good faith, and that is where for instance, an unworthy spouse. I've lost my place. Yes, it would be foreseeable that title could pass to a former spouse from an executor, perhaps, unknowing that the couple had been divorced or the marriage had been annulled. So the unworthy spouse could then pass the property on to a third person. And under the law of unjustified enrichment, the unworthy spouse would have to return that property to the estate or the value thereof. And what section 2.4 does is it protects the third party and says that their title will be protected, so they don't have to give the property back. And that actually replicates section 19.3 of the Family Law Scotland Act and section 124A3 of the Civil Partnership Act, which also afford that protection presently, but just combines them in a way that they're easily accessible in one section.
Okay, thank you very much.
Just to be absolutely clear, is that an unqualified protection for the third party purchaser or acquirer? And the reason I ask that is I just have my devious mind. If there were an arrangement between the, quote, using your phrase, unworthy spouse and a third party to minimise, for example, the benefit that the unworthy spouse acquired, knowing that there might subsequently be doubt about the whole transaction to the unworthy spouse, in an attempt to protect that asset, which might be somebody with whom the unworthy spouse now had a relationship. You know, in other words, and I'm sure there could be lots of other examples, is it an unqualified right that's being created, or is it a qualified right, or would it be caught by other legal provisions?
As you say, that's a foreseeable situation, and it's a qualified right, so it depends on the third party acting in good faith.
So the test is the third party has to be acting in good faith.
Yes. Yep.
Right, that's helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. If I could then take us on to rectification of a will and sections 3 and 4, please. I note what is in the bill, but I also note that the Law Society and indeed Trustbar commented that there might be other ways of doing this and suggested that they could at least see alternatives and maybe not be terribly happy with what is proposed. My first question, I suppose, is given that level of discussion, is it appropriate that what we've got in front of us actually isn't a bill in front of this committee? Are we actually dealing with something which is sufficiently non-contentious?
Yes, I think it is sufficiently non-contentious. I think the Trustbar comments, you know, many of them are around the detail, and it's not that they have a different legal effect, it's the way that it would be achieved. And, I mean, we've only very recently, yesterday, written to both Trustbar and the Law Society about the detail of the comments that they submitted to the committee, outlining our position on some of them and seeking clarification on others. And we hope then to have a bit of a dialogue with them and as things progress. But, yes, I don't think their comments take the provisions out of the realm of something that would be suitable for this committee to look at.
Grateful to you for that advice. I also note, if I can turn on to the date of the application for rectification, I note Michael Kuzner's, and indeed I think also Trustbar, again made comments about this. The particular suggestion I'd pick up on is the fact that confirmation can sometimes take a very long time. I'm wondering whether the timetable for rectification might be set at the date of death rather than the date of confirmation, because otherwise things maybe just run on for potentially almost open-ended.
I mean, that's one of the points that we've included in our letter to Trustbar, because I think they and us are of the view that whatever happens, it shouldn't be unduly delayed. It should be as, you know, it should be a kind of as quick as possible. And they've made a suggestion of 2 years. We're not quite sure that would meet the within reasonable time limits either. So there is maybe something that needs to be worked out there and considered. And that's something, as I say, we've picked up with them.
Right. So something we could expect you to come back on at some stage, having flagged up the issue. That's fine. Thank you. If I could then just consider the effect of revocation on a will and of course, the possibility that the second or subsequent will might actually be struck down, for example, for incapacity, and the possibility then that it might have been the testator's wish that the earlier will would have been revived because it might be the only extant testament that makes any sense. Has anybody considered whether or not that there should be an exception, at least perhaps within the court's discretion?
Yes, well, Section 5 would only apply where a will revokes another will, so it would not apply where a court reduces a will. So if the court were to reduce a will and or sorry, if a will revokes an earlier will and that will is itself reduced by the court, then there's nothing to revoke the earlier will. So the usual state, the normal will would remain as it is, and Section 5 would not apply. So the bill does not affect that situation.
Are we sure that's what we want to happen, though? Is that a policy? Sorry, that sounds like a policy statement, which I'm just in questioning. I mean, is that actually what we want the policy to say?
I think in these circumstances that sounds right, yes.
Uh-huh. Right, thank you. I do as well, but I'm just conscious that we maybe need to think about that.
No.
Exceptional, rather rare.
I think that if it were not the case, then obviously if a person revokes their will, then they do so knowing that their will revive or not revive. Whereas if a court revokes a will, the testator may not even, sorry, reduces a will, the testator may not have been aware, they may have already died, or so they wouldn't want it to revert to intestacy. So I think that the old will, there is a policy justification for that.
Do forgive a layperson's question. I just want to be clear that I understand what reducing a bill means. In effect, that is taking bits of the will out so they don't have effect. Is there a difference when the reduction in the will takes you to a position of nullity of the will? Or is it all the same?
What generally happen is an application is made to the Court of Session, and the Court of Session, usually when they reduce the will, the whole will fail. But there is case law where a code, I can't remember the case name off the top of my head, but I can write to you on that, where the part of a will was deemed to have been reduced and the rest of it subsisted. So I think that in answer to your question, the whole will would generally fall.
The essence of my question is there is in fact no distinction between a partial reduction and a total reduction.
Generally speaking, the whole will would be reduced.
Do forgive me, the word generally speaking is a bit of a weasel word, so you're saying... There is a little bit of uncertainty. It would be up to the courts to determine.
It would be up to the courts, yeah. And, it would be up to the Court of Session.
And at the end of the day, that's not an unreasonable place to be. Right. I don't think you need to give us the legal reference, do we? Okay. Okay.
Very, very grateful for any reduction of work is welcome at this stage. I think the next session on legacies is with James. Is that right?
Yeah, thanks a lot, convener. In terms of Section 6 and 24, there were some specific comments made by Trust Bar and the Law Society. Trust Bar had concerns about the position in Section 6.2 in relation to someone deciding that a testator deciding that they didn't want Section 6 generally applying to them, and how that interacts with the other provisions in Section 6. So I just wondered what you made of Trustbar's comments on that.
So is this about how Section 6 interacts with the somebody wants to renounce their legal rights?
Yes, that's right.
Yes, Section 6 wouldn't apply in that situation because Section 6 deals with a legacy, so it doesn't deal with the situation where it doesn't deal with legal rights. So under Section 6, it restates it places on a statutory footing a conditio, which is that where an individual dies between a legacy being granted and that legacy vesting, their issue can step into their shoes and take their share of the legacy, and legal rights. It wouldn't apply to legal rights. Legal rights would the equivalent provision would be Section 11 of the 1964 Act, which says that someone can step in. Issue can step into the shoes of an individual where they aren't able to take their legal rights through predecease.
So the testator has got to be absolutely clear in terms of 6.2 that they don't want Section 6 to apply.
Section 6 wouldn't apply in respect of legal rights, but in terms of the legacy, the testator could make provision in their will which overrode the statutory presumption in Section 6. So previously that wouldn't have been allowed. In the common law previously, the issue would be presumed to have favoured over whoever the testator had made as an alternative. However, now the situation will be that if alternative provision is made in the will, that will override the statutory presumption. Is that clear? Sorry.
Yeah. In terms of the Law Society's comments around Section 6.6, they had a feeling that there was a definition on issue, and they felt that should be made clearer to ensure how it related to adopted children and stepchildren. Is that something that you've had some interaction with the Law Society and Trustfire? Is that something you've taken on board and discussed with them?
We don't think there's actually needs to be much done to it, because the term issue means direct descendants of every degree, so whether that's child, grandchild, etc. And it will cover descendants through adoption by virtue of Section 23 of the Succession Scotland 1964 Act. So the definition of issue already includes adopted children, and it excludes stepchildren. And that was the view of the Scottish Law Commission, and that's our view. So the answer is there already. Whether it needs to be made clearer is something we'll certainly reflect on, but that's the position. So issue would include adopted children but exclude stepchildren.
Right, so that's your policy position. Which
yes,
is
and that's what the law provides. I think the question is just whether we need to make that clearer, whether it's necessary to make it clearer.
Okay,
yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. I think survivorship is with Stuart.
Indeed. There are some questions being raised about simultaneity of decease and the use of the word uncertain. And I suppose the first question is, how do we decide that we're uncertain? You know, how does that work in practice? Because Trustbar are criticising the use of the word uncertain. I think I can posit for myself that one can be certain one's uncertain in some circumstances, but in other circumstances, one can remain uncertain as to whether one's uncertain.
I think the order of death is uncertain if it's not possible to prove on a balance of probabilities a particular order. So that was discussed in the case of Lamb against Lord Advocate. And that is the standard. It's the balance of probabilities.
Can I just on that? Yeah. I'm content with that as an answer. Who determines the balance of probability? In other words, is it the trustees or is it the courts?
It would be the trustees in the first instance, but if the beneficiaries were unhappy, and for instance, you thought, then it would go to the court.
Could I observe, forgive me, that I think this is one of the worrying things of the whole thing, and it's not just this particular bill. Because every single one of us in this room could find ourselves in a position of being an executor of a will. And we're ordinary folk, and most executors are. And find themselves in a position of being a trustee. Of course, we then have to take some legal advice. But if we're not sure what uncertain means, how on earth is an ordinary trustee supposed to make that judgment? How on earth can an ordinary person, suddenly finding themselves having to do this, she didn't choose to do this, and you certainly don't choose the timing of it, then to make a judgment which they then might have to defend in court against litigious potential beneficiaries?
I mean, the sheer practicalities of getting the appropriate legal advice that I, as a lay trustee, can get a defensible position is one which I think worries me enormously. And I'm just wondering what your response to that is, please.
I think that's something that we need to reflect on, because I think you're right, we can assume that people, particularly in the legal profession, are aware of certain terms, and it's a point well made. I think we can reflect on that and write to the committee.
I think if you could, that would be helpful too, because I was thinking earlier on, we were talking about lawyers' understanding. This is fair enough, of course. I mean, I have a great respect for lawyers. But if there's one thing that we all individually as adults need to do, it's write a will. I think that's a pretty basic message. Therefore, it actually affects every single adult member of our society. And making sure that people understand what they should do is a pretty important part of I would have thought, governmental action, because it's difficult to see who else's responsibility it might be. Yeah, thank you. Stuart, feel free, please.
You're perfectly correct, Convener. I can actually tell you that my mother, in 1912, aged three, was the executor for her grandfather, according to her grandfather's will. But let's just pass on. Her father undertook the role, but I just thought to myself, why did her grandfather do that? Right. But more fundamentally, before we move off survivorship and uncertainty, there is potentially a need to address the issue where there is deemed to be simultaneity or uncertainty about the estate falling to the Crown. Do we think that's a satisfactory position to be, rather than actually the estate passing to other relatives?
Trust bar made,
yeah.
And I think that's certainly one that we're going to reflect on. I mean, I take the point that we are talking about very small numbers, probably tiny numbers, but nevertheless, we need to think it through, and that's something that we've decided we should reflect on, because it probably isn't the best outcome necessarily.
Well, in particular, if the will actually referred to other relatives and other people, it would seem perverse that the law should deprive them of the right to inherit simply because of uncertainty about whether there's simultaneity or actual unresolvable uncertainty about the order of death. So at least speaking as an individual rather than anything else, I would encourage you to think very carefully about that, because I think we'll come back to that if we don't. I will anyway, if I don't like what I hear subsequently.
Again, but I'm just wondering whether, in considering that, you might like to reflect on whether there are circumstances where something should be down to the discretion of a court. Now, I recognise that that's perhaps generally what we're trying not to do, because otherwise you have an infinite, total population number of cases. But I wonder whether, in the situation where, for example, entire branch of the family dies in a car crash, which will be rare, it might be open to a court to decide what might be reasonable, rather than going to look at testamentary documents, which will have borne very little resemblance to what anybody thought should happen in those circumstances.
I think that, just to clarify one thing that you'd mentioned earlier, if there was provision in the will, that would take effect. It's where there is no provision in the will, and
it's when we've run out of implementable provisions, in effect.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, that's helpful.
And as you say, the court would be another option.
Yes.
It's plainly not the third option most of the time, or everybody finishes up in court, and that's exactly what we want to avoid. But it might be. I'll leave that with you as something you might like to reflect on in those very exceptional cases. I'm hoping, Stuart, that now takes us to forfeiture.
Indeed, I thought it might do, Convener. Yes, and in particular, why we're abolishing the Parricide Act at this stage rather than simply leaving its provisions.
Back in 1990, the Scottish Law Commission's report, which was the precursor to their 2009 report, they recommended that the common law of forfeiture should be put on a statutory footing, and at the same time the Parricide Act should be abolished. but by the time of their 2009 report, they'd actually shifted their position because they considered it wasn't necessary to abolish the common law of forfeiture because it was actually used very rarely and it worked very well when it had to. But they still recommended that the Parricide Act should be abolished. So there is no recommendation to put the common law of forfeiture on a statutory footing, which I think the respondent thought that's what should happen before the Parricide Act should be abolished. And we're content with that, that the common law works fine and the Parricide Act is unnecessary because the common law covers what was previously in the Parricide Act.
So the working of the law subsequent to the passage of the bill that's before us is that the legal fiction is created that the person who benefits has, in succession law terms, died before the person who provides the benefit.
That's the change that the bill will introduce, yes.
Which, of course, seems an interesting legal concept that one is simultaneously alive and dead.
And
as I said last week, the Schrödinger will be interested if he were still alive because of.
He
is. I don't think he is, convener.
I think he's passed on.
Anyway, the other thing that's been raised is. Why you think it's appropriate in policy terms for the court to be able to grant an unlawful killer 100% relief from the effects of forfeiture. I give, in my own mind, the example that people who've assisted people to travel to the Dignitas clinic in Switzerland, which might be an unlawful act, but actually is what the person who dies wanted to happen. I can see there might be subject to the courts looking at it, circumstances where 100% relief might be appropriate. Is that the sort of thing that the government had in its mind when it's contemplating 100% relief, or there are other circumstances?
Yes, I mean, the granting of relief is discretionary, and in a way the court is hampered at the moment, and there was a case, it was Cross was the petitioner in 1987, and the judge in that case felt that they could only actually grant 100% relief on the heritable property and 99% relief on the movable property. And so it was an artificial divide. So if we're giving discretion to the courts, they should have the ability to exercise their discretion right to the limit. And the sorts of circumstances in which they have granted relief, not total relief because they don't feel they can, are things like there was a suicide pact that went wrong, or someone who had been abused in an abusive relationship and they had killed someone in self-defence and accidentally. So that sort of thing, which might chime with your example. But it's just to open up the full percentage to the court so that they don't have this kind of artificial line.
Okay. Thank you. That takes us on to protection of trustees with John, please.
Section 18 talks about estate administration and errors in distribution with the protection of trustees and executors in certain circumstances. And it was just to really seek clarification about the duty to make reasonable inquiries about the existence of potential beneficiaries. Will that be expected? Do we expect that to be interpreted as there will be a duty to advertise? Because it doesn't specifically in the bill mention a duty to advertise, but it might be assumed that that will almost automatically become the case. And following on from that, then, if that was the case, is that just going to delay the whole process of administering estates?
What I'd say is that reasonable inquiries is a commonly understood term. And it wouldn't involve advertising. Where there's a duty to advertise, that would be set out in the legislation. So what constitutes reasonable inquiries, while it's commonly understood, really where there's any dispute on it, it would fall to the court to consider in the circumstances of the case whether or not somebody had acted reasonably within their professional responsibilities. So yeah, it wouldn't require advertisement.
Fall to the courts, will people play safe and just tend to advertise maybe more often than we would expect them to need to?
I don't think so, purely on the basis that it is a commonly understood term, and making reasonable inquiries as to advertising as to whether or not someone's adopted isn't going to necessarily going to, you're probably not going to get many answers back to that. Reasonable inquiries would be more speaking with family members, checking that what the family relationships are. So I don't think advertisement would really be particularly helpful in the circumstances anyway.
If I could perhaps add to that, the Law Commission considered this in 1990 as to whether there should be a specific duty to advertise as part of reasonable inquiries, and they determined that there shouldn't be a specific duty because it could give undue weight to that form of reasonable inquiry, and people may think that they only require essentially to advertise rather than to make further reasonable inquiries. And they also stated that they felt that it was a commonly understood term, as my colleague said, so they didn't feel it was there was merit in defining that further. In fact, I think they felt it could hamper it if it was defined further in the legislation, which is why we've not done so.
Okay, thank you.
Super. Thank you. Stuart, sorry, Charles.
Just in this narrow and specific context, it would be interesting to just know what it is thought might constitute reasonable inquiries. And I give two suggestions as to what it might be. It might be the employment of private inquiry agents to track down missing people, or the employment of professional genealogists to find unknown parts of a family. Is that the sort of thing that reasonable inquiry might be thought to include?
Again, I think it would probably depend on the circumstances of the case. For example, I would say that's quite a high level to conduct those sort of reports. However, if a member of the family had said to the executor, we think there's an adoptive sister, then it would be for them to make more extensive inquiries than they might have usually. So I think really it would be context specific, and it would really depend on the circumstances of the case.
I suggest families more often than you might imagine don't know of relatives. And I say that in our family, we discovered a cousin that we'd no knowledge of whatsoever, who was born in 1943 and is still living. And we discovered that in the last 2 years. Absolutely no knowledge whatsoever.
Okay, can I move this on? So forgive me. I mean, these things do happen. I entirely accept that. I'm wondering whether John Scott's got another question, please.
Thank you. And can I now take you to Section 22 in private international law and in the generality ask you whether it's desirable that reforms to this complex subject like private international law will be split over two separate succession bills. Do you think that's reasonable?
Yes, to the extent that the recommendations will apply as far as they can to this bill, and they'll apply in any future legislation. And there isn't a kind of tension between doing that. They just apply to the extent that they do.
Okay.
No more, no less.
And also, recommendation 50 appears to not be completely implemented in the bill. Is that... can you explain that, please?
Again, I would just mirror what my colleague says, that it is implemented insofar as it relates to the bill provisions. So it is implemented. It's just that where perhaps one provision requires a testator to be domiciled in Scotland, you only need to note the grounds of jurisdiction where a person is domiciled in Scotland. So it applies insofar as it relates.
Okay. Right, thanks so much.
Okay, I think James has the last question of the proposals at the moment.
Yeah, convener. The Law Society in their submission had made the point that there were two issues that were consulted on but not included in the bill, and they were bonds of caution and the effect of the birth of a child. Can you maybe just explain your rationale in not including those in the bill?
There's actually, I think, about four or five things that we consulted on that haven't appeared in the bill, and bonds of caution, the conditio about the child, there's temporary aliment and aliment jure representationis, and recommendation 46, which was about jointly held foreign movable property. Neither of these feature in this bill, and that's just because we got a very mixed reaction to them. So on bonds of caution, there was a lot of support for abolishing it, which was the main question, but then a lot of uncertainty about what safeguards we needed instead. Generally, people were against the conditio one. There was a majority against. Similarly, on the other two alimentary provisions, which were they were actually grouped with mournings, and mournings is the only one that we've progressed into this bill. So on all of those things, we're actually consulting again. They're being consulted on right now in the second consultation, and some of that's moved on a bit because we've been able to take an initial view, and perhaps now we're just looking at what safeguards we need for bonds of caution as opposed to the principle of it. And recommendation 46, which is the joint foreign movable property, doesn't feature in the second consultation, but we're just going to keep that in mind as that progresses. So generally it was because there was mixed support and mixed views, and we decided that they needed another examination.
Okay, thank you.
Which is, of course, entirely consistent with this committee's remit and the legislation that should be in front of us. Slightly strange, though, that might seem from the outside. Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of our prepared questions, and I think that brings us to the end of this particular section. So thank you very much, and I'm proposing we suspend the meeting for just a couple of minutes, at least in order to allow the witnesses to change over. Thank you.
It's an opportunity to reconvene. And I welcome from the Scottish Law Commission Caroline Drummond, who is the Commissioner for this bill, and Charles Garland, who's the Project Manager for this bill. Welcome back. I think that this may be Caroline's first formal appearance before this committee, so it's very good to see you. And questions will roughly follow what we have just asked the Scottish Government, and will therefore be led by John Mason.
Okay. Hey, thanks, Convener. And the first area I just wanted to touch on was the fact that we have two succession bills around at the moment, and just whether your feeling is that that is causing or could cause confusion either for practitioners or those who are less involved in this area.
Well, firstly, as our initial report on this was 1990, we're absolutely delighted to see any bill taking it forward. It would be good, as far as we're concerned, if these bills could be consolidated in the end of the day and brought together so that there's one place, not just for practitioners to see clearly, but for the general public to be able to consult. So that would be our preferred option, but it's understood the government has to look at that once the next consultation's finished.
But you're happy that they have gone with the approach of two bills rather than waiting and maybe having them all later?
Yes, we are happy that this is going ahead because there. It's non-controversial, we think. So we're happy that it's gone ahead.
Okay, thank you. And secondly, the Law Society felt that if we were amending the actual Act once it's passed, that should be done by further primary legislation rather than by regulations. I mean, do you have a view on that as to how that should have happened?
Well, the legislative timetable is a busy one, and to get primary legislation through, it seems to us, is quite difficult. So we've heard the government's explanation on amendments, and they have said that there's appropriate constraints. So, yes, we're happy with that.
It seems quite wide, but you're still satisfied with that?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And the third one is the whole issue of retrospection. I mean, it's been raised that people were concerned that if any parts of the legislation could be commenced, that would affect people who have already, well, either died or already had their will put in place. Again, are you comfortable with the way that the government has dealt with that?
Yes. In our view, it's always better if you can tell from the face of a bill when it comes into effect. But the government policy is to have a commencement order and to deal with it in that way. And as we'll have a chance to look at that in advance, yes, we're happy with the position.
Okay, thank you.
Can I, on retrospection, just ask whether you're comfortable that all the provisions have been translated in the best way? Because clearly there are some things that we do want to change the general law of the land and to affect every will that is thereafter brought into effect. But there are some where you would not want somebody drawing up a will to be having to change it because you've changed the law under their feet. So is the balance of that right in your view?
Yes, we think it is.
Thank you. I think that takes us on to John Scott, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. And I'm moving now to section one, and can I just ask you what the policy rationale is for including guardianship in the scope of section one, and would you like to explain your position on that and what you think the drawbacks are to that approach, please?
Well, the Scottish Law Commission included guardianship in their 1990 report, and they included it again in the 2009 report. So our view was that it's been considered in detail on two separate occasions. So we are happy with that. And we're happy with the draft as it stands. As the Scottish Government said, it's going to be quite an unusual situation where you've got a spouse without parental responsibilities who's appointed as a guardian. So, yes, we're happy with that.
You're happy with that? You don't think that Law Society have a point in as much as they think there are drawbacks? Not really?
No, I mean, if If the spouse has parental responsibilities, I don't think it's an issue. So I was quite surprised at their point, but heartened to hear that the government are in discussion with them to get to the bottom of that.
Okay, thank you very much. I would also like to ask you whether you think there's merit in Trustbar's suggestion that Section 1 should operate at the point when the marriage or civil partnership ends and not at the point the testator dies. We've had a pretty full explanation of that from the Scottish Government, but just interested to hear your views on that as well.
No, we don't agree with the Trustbar point, and we think it would introduce concerns. There would be multi-layering of where a person was when they married. They could get married again, die again. This is the law of succession we're looking at. We need to look at it when they died, we feel.
Okay. Right. Thank you. And the final question is whether you think there's merit in Trustbar's view that protection for people acquiring property in good faith, Section 2.4, is unnecessary because property subject to a special destination passes automatically without any need for an executor. Again, already discussed.
We think that there's merit in having all the provisions relating to succession in the one place for people to look at. So we don't think this is unnecessary. We're happy with it and that it relates to both heritage and movable property.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, if I might move on to the power of rectification. As we did before, I think the Scottish Government made it quite clear that they felt that comments about rectification from the Law Society and Trustbar did not affect the general principle, and therefore that was not sufficiently contentious for it to be in the second bill, point which I think I would be interested in your comments on if you have any. But I would go on to that further point about whether or not the time limits for rectification should come from the point of confirmation or the point of death, and the point fairly made that confirmation can take a very long time, and therefore this could get open-ended.
Well, subsection 2 of section 3 does give the court the ability to extend these time limits, as I understand it. So,
with a relatively short time limit that would be subject to court's discretion, as many things are?
Yes.
Right, that does make a... Seem to be, thank you, fair way forward. I think that actually takes us on to James's section at page 10, if that's all right.
Okay, this pertains to section 6, which deals with death before legacy vesting. There was a couple of comments, one from Trustbar and one from the Law Society, which we picked up earlier. Just wondered in terms of what Trustbar were getting at was the provision in section 6.2 for section 6 generally not to apply in relation to the test data, and whether that resulted in any confusion or anything that was needing clarification there. To be clear, Section 6.2 allows for, it gives the test data the right for Section 6 not to, the provisions in Section 6 not to apply. Trustbar had some concerns around whether that was clear enough and that would override any other comments.
Yes. I don't share Trustbar's concern on that. I think we're perfectly happy with the drafting as it stands. I don't know, have you got anything to say on 6.2?
Just to add that I think that is covered by the Scottish Government's letter to Trustbar, who the members of Trustbar will clearly have detailed practical experience, and if they can point to examples of the way a will might be drafted or might typically be drafted which could give rise to concern, then those will obviously need to be taken into account. And it seemed to be over the definition of a residue clause.
Yeah.
But I think it's probably right that they be given a chance to explain the possible doubt here.
Okay. In terms of the Law Society, their point related to the definition of issue in Section 6.6, and we heard from the Scottish Government earlier that the Law Society were concerned around how that impacted on adopted children and stepchildren, believing that they were not included. The Scottish Government have explained that it does apply to adopted children but not stepchildren, and have taken a policy decision that's the approach they wanted to take. Do you have any comments on that?
Perfectly happy with that and with their explanation.
It seems right, because the adopted children lose the right on adoption to claim any rights against their natural parents. Stepchildren, that's not true. So including stepchildren here would give them two bites of the cherry, effectively.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I think that takes us to Stuart.
In the answers that we got from the government on simultaneity of death or uncertainty of the sequence of death, the government said that it would be determined on the balance of probabilities, which is a kind of standard thing to say. Are the Scottish Law Commission content that trustees' executors will be able to operate on that basis, particularly if they do not have legal advice and not get themselves in difficulties?
Yes, I think we were perfectly happy with that. We didn't share Trustbar's concern about the law being uncertain on uncertainty. The case quoted by Trustbar seemed quite clear to us what the word uncertain meant. And certainly the word uncertain has been in the Scottish Law Commission's reports throughout. As to what happens in practice, I think it will be useful if you are discussing with practitioners what their experience of this is. I suspect there's generally accepted practice in this area. But we don't have any difficulty with the word uncertain. We were perfectly happy with that.
So the use of the word uncertain in this context is not in any way novel in relation to previous use of that word in Scots law?
No.
That's sufficient. Thank you.
I'm wondering whether I could take this opportunity of just raising the issue which effectively I raised with the Scottish Government, which is to recognise that most people who are executors of wills are lay people, sometimes with a very small L. And I'm just wondering to what extent the Scottish Law Commission actually consulted with those who are lay people and have had some experience of doing this, because I guess if you hadn't had an experience, you would have nothing much to say, in order to try and make sure that the law that we're propagating is one which can be effectively worked by people who come to it all of a sudden, unwillingly and without a legal background.
Well, as I understand it, going back to our original consultation, which culminated in the 1990 report, there was a consultation with members of the public, and we do have handwritten submissions from that time in our old files. So there was a level of consultation done.
There was indeed also in 2007, although most of the topics consulted on then aren't the ones which are in the present bill, but there has been an opportunity for members of the public, which some members of the public have taken that up, particularly those who found themselves in a situation where they regard the law as treating them particularly unfairly, to make strong representations.
I'm wondering whether you would be in a position. Clearly, it's not something you can do now, but whether you would be in a position to to help the government to produce the guidance, which is surely going to be necessary, possibly once we have got both bills through, and possibly even once that's been consolidated in such a way that the man or woman in the street can read up on this and doesn't have to go and talk to a lawyer about how to be an executive, because I think our job as MSPs is to try to make sure that lawyers deal with what they have to. And not what they don't have to, because it tends to be expensive, and that's the way we protect our constituents.
D, indeed. I think the government's guidance on this, their notes on this, is very good, but we are absolutely delighted to help with that moving forward.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know if I could just add, I hope it's not too much of a plug, but executors in Scots law are generally, for almost all purposes, treated as trustees, and the law of trusts is obviously a law that is complicated in its own right and is antique in a way which makes succession law look relatively modern. And our report on that was published last year and is something which we hope that will be coming into the Parliament before too long to reform the law of which applies generally to trustees, but obviously that will include executors. And there will be a number of clear benefits, but one of which will be that the law will on trustees and therefore on executors will be collected together and expressed in modern language.
I take that as a heartfelt plea, which has not fallen entirely on deaf ears. Let's hope the government is listening. Stuart.
When the government gave its evidence earlier this morning in relation to where a family perishes together and the destination of assets at present broadly being to the Crown, the government indicated that it's going back and thinking further on that. What might the Scottish Law Commission advise the government if asked on this subject?
I think that our two reports, particularly the original 1990 report, make excellent reading in this respect, and I don't think we would have anything more to add than that.
So the advice is read your previous reports?
Again.
In essence, yes. Right, well, that's perfectly content with that. Right, moving on to parricide and forfeiture. In particular, I think the key one here is probably the 100% relief. Whether the Scottish Law Commission have any issues with the existence of 100% relief, or any belief that there will be difficulties in the courts dealing with that.
We're very content with this provision, and like the government, it seemed artificial that a court could only award 99%. They should have a full discretion if they have discretion, was our view.
And on artificiality, given that the legal mechanism for depriving a beneficiary of the fruits of their illegal act is by legally deciding that for that purpose they are dead before the person who was killed, is there not, since that sounds very odd, since that these people will die twice in law, is there not a better legal mechanism by which this can be achieved? I understand the practical effects, and I see that, but it does sound to the layperson a distinctly odd approach to take in one's common understanding of the term death.
It is only death for this particular very narrow purpose. It doesn't just appear in this section. It appears in sections 1 and 2 of this bill as well. And it is, for this purpose, a very useful assumption.
Well, no, I understand that. I'm only saying that you know, to be both dead and undead simultaneously, while atomic physicists are perfectly content to deal with that. The example of Schrodinger's cat has been referred to. It does seem that perhaps the legal profession in all its manifestations might think of some more useful terminology to in future. We're clear where we are on this.
Yes, I think they will struggle. I think there have been attempts to avoid using this and they've all failed in the past.
It doesn't happen very often. I could suggest that we move on, though we do need, as I said before, to make sure the law is right, even for those rare events. John, can you take us to protection for trustees, which I'm sure is a very common concern?
Yes, I think so. Section 18 talks about protection of trustees and executors in certain circumstances where there's been errors in distribution. And it says that there will be no blame if the trustees have acted in good faith after such inquiries as any reasonable and prudent trustee would have made in the circumstances of the case. And I'm just wondering in practice how that's going to work out, and if it will become the norm that there should be advertising going on. And my fear with advertising would just be that it would delay procedures and concluding an estate.
Do you want to deal with the consolidation?
The measure which is in the bill at the moment is the existing law, so we would hope that there is already an established body of practice. The fact that the provision therefore consolidates existing law may be less significant than that. There are differences in the way that people's relationships may be established, or people may be traced, and it is possible that whereas once putting an advert in a newspaper, for example, might have been a reasonable precaution which would attract the immunity from liability, it may be now that more would need to be done, and that electronic means of trying to track people down, or electronic advertisements and so on, might be used. So we hope that the existing practice would simply carry on, but itself would need to be adapted to what was reasonable in the in view of the kinds of tracing which can reasonably be done. It is now much more simple for somebody to take these measures perhaps in hand themselves than it once was.
I mean, I think that's a reasonable answer, because I accept that there is established law in place, and it doesn't seem to have been a problem up till now. I suppose I just wonder, as you've mentioned yourself, the means of communication are changing, and also it seems to me that relationships are changing as well, and the traditional family unit is less common, perhaps. And it just seems quite vague to me, but if you're satisfied with it, fair enough. Because I suppose, you know, the fear would be that somehow through this there's going to end up being delays in concluding matters.
We don't see that this would give rise to additional delays.
Okay, thank you.
Just do forgive me, as somebody who's been involved in genealogy for over 50 years, that information being online merely makes it simpler to be confused, because the records that one looks at are all informed by what people believe to be correct rather than actually objective fact. And I could, off record, give you lots of examples where what is actually on a death certificate, birth certificate, marriage certificate is not correct, but was given in good faith.
John, would you like to take us forward, please?
Yes, moving now to private international law, section 22. I just wanted to make certain that you, to hear your views as to whether it's desirable to reform to this complex subject. Private international law will be split over the two succession bills. Are you content with that as well?
Yes, we are content with the approach. It will only apply insofar as it relates to this bill, and the same with the next one. So, yes, we're content with that approach.
That's fine. That's all I wanted to hear. Thank you.
And James, I think you are tailgunner again.
Yeah, convener, just a quick one to finish off. The Scottish Government indicated earlier that there were five proposals that were consulted on, but then not taken forward in the bill, and they outlined some of the reasoning behind that. Are you content with that approach?
Yes. While we would like all our recommendations to be enacted, that would be great. We appreciate that these were contentious, and therefore the government are reconsulting at the moment, which is great.
Okay.
Thank you. I think that brings us to the end of questions. Can I thank you very much for your succinct and lucid answers? And that ends this item on the agenda. And I think at this moment, again, I'll suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to depart, and then we'll sort out what we do next. That brings us to agenda item 3, which is instruments subject to negative procedure, and no points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Reservoir Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015, SSO 2015-315. Is the committee content with that instrument, please?
Yes.
Okay. Agenda item 4, instruments not subject to parliamentary procedure, the Act of Sederunt, Rules of the Court of Session 1994, and Sheriff Court Rules Amendment No. 3, Miscellaneous 2015, SSI 2015-283. This instrument contains a minor drafting error in the Form 70, which is inserted by Schedule 1. Provision on the signing of the form has been omitted. The Lord President's private office has acknowledged this omission and undertaken to lay an amendment to correct it. Does the committee agree to draw this instrument to the attention of the Parliament on the general reporting ground, as it contains a minor drafting error?
Agree.
Yep. No points have been raised by our legal advisers on the Reservoirs Scotland Act 2011 Commencement No. 4, Order 2015, SSI 2015-314. Is the committee content with that instrument, please?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Agenda item 5, the Higher Education Governance Scotland Bill. Purpose of this item is for the committee to consider the delegated powers provisions in the bill at stage 1, to agree the questions it wishes to raise with the Scottish Government on the delegated powers in the bill in written correspondence. We will have an opportunity, of course, to consider those responses at a future meeting in order to inform the draft report. Section 1 provides that the chairing member of the governing body of a higher education institution, hereafter HEI, is to be appointed in accordance with the process set out in regulations made by the Scottish ministers. The process for appointment of chairing members of governing bodies is a key policy in the bill and is understood to be a matter of controversy amongst HEI stakeholders. Does the committee to agree to ask the Scottish Government, A, to explain why it is considered appropriate for the basic framework for the appointment of chairing members to be postponed to secondary legislation, and B, to consider whether the basic framework for appointment of chairing members could be set out on the face of the bill and therefore be made subject to full parliamentary consultation and debate, with the detail of the process to be set out in regulations?
Agree.
Section 2 provides that Scottish ministers may by regulation make provision for remuneration and allowances to be payable by an HEI to the chairing member of the governing body of the institution. The principle of remuneration for chairing members is a new concept for HEIs and is understood to have met with opposition amongst their stakeholders. Does the committee agree to ask the Scottish Government to explain why it is considered appropriate for the principle and basic framework of remuneration and chairing members to be postponed to secondary legislation, and to consider whether the principle and basic framework of remuneration for chairing members could be set on the face of the bill and therefore be made subject to full parliamentary consultation and debate, with the details set out in the regulations?
Yes.
Section 8 gives a power to the Scottish ministers to modify Section 4 of the bill, which sets out the requirements for the composition of the governing body of an HEI. Proposed requirements as to the composition of governing bodies set out in the bill are understood to have met with opposition amongst HEIs. Does the committee agree to ask the Scottish Government to consider whether a requirement could be included on the face of the bill for Scottish ministers to consult affected HEIs before making regulations under Section 8 to modify such requirements, in similar terms to the existing requirement for consultation before exercising the powers in Sections 1 and 2 of the bill?
Okay.
Section 13 gives the power to Scottish ministers to modify Sections 9 and 10 of the bill, which set out the requirements for the size and composition of the academic board of an HEI. Proposed requirements as to the size and composition of the academic board set out in the bill are understood to have met with opposition among HEIs. Does the committee therefore agree to ask the Scottish Government to consider whether a requirement could be included on the face of the bill for Scottish ministers to consult affected HEIs before making regulations under Section 13 to modify such requirements in similar terms to the existing requirements for consultation before exercising the powers under Sections 1 and 2? Section 15.1 sets out the definition of an HEI for the purposes of Part 1 of the Bill. HEI has the same meaning as a Further and Higher Education Scotland Act 2005, that is, a university or institution providing higher education designated by the Secretary of State. However, a university or designated institution falls within the definition only if it is also listed in Schedule 2 as fundable bodies to that Act. Schedule 2 lists those bodies which may receive funding from the Scottish Further and Higher Education Funding Council. The Open University is specifically excluded from that definition. Section 15.2 provides that Scottish ministers may by regulations modify the definition set out in Section 15.1 so as to include or exclude a particular institution. Given that the definition of HEI determines which institutions are subject to the governance requirements set out in the bill, changes to the definition to include or exclude a particular institution could have a sizable impact on that institution. Does the committee agree to ask the Scottish Government, A, for clarification as to why a power to include a higher education institution in the definition is required, since it appears the definition in the bill will already catch all universities in it and designated institutions other than the Open University, which may receive funding from the Scottish Further and Higher Education Funding Council by virtue of being included in Schedule 2 to the Further and Higher Education Scotland Act 2005. B, for examples of when a power to include an HEE in the definition might be used. C, why the negative procedure is considered appropriate in this case, given the potential impact of modification of the definition so as to include a particular higher education institution or an institution in question. And D, to consider whether a requirement could be included on the face of the bill for ministers to consult affected HEIs before making any regulations under Section 15, again, given the potential impact on affected institutions in similar terms to the existing requirement of consultation before exercising the powers in Sections 1 and 2 of the bill. Thank you. Agenda item 6 is Inquiries into Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths, etc. Scotland Bill. This item of business is for the committee to consider the Scottish Government's response to its Stage 1 report. Do members have any comments, please? Are we content to note that response and, if necessary, reconsider the bill after Stage 2? We are. Thank you very much. That ends Agenda item 6. And again, I suspend this meeting and we will resume with Item 7 relatively soon. Thank you. Right, thank you very much, and I reconvene the meeting. Agenda item 7 is the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exemptions Scotland Amendment Order 2015 in draft. Members will have before them the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Amendment Order 2015, and a draft of the Associated Police Act 1997 and the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007, Remedial Order 2015. The draft order was laid yesterday and provided to members, along with the draft of the Remedial Order shortly after laying. We have today before us the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning, so as to enable us to scrutinise that draft order. The proposed approach to this draft order, which we expect Parliament will be invited to agree this afternoon, does not allow for any detailed scrutiny of the order. In the limited time available to the committee, we will do our best we can today to scrutinise the draft order, but having only received that order yesterday afternoon and having only this morning in which to consider the draft order, there are clearly limits as to the level of things that we can do. This is, of course, a most unusual approach to consideration of an order, and not one we expect, of course, will happen again very soon. While we can do what we can in the time available to us to scrutinise this draft order, the committee does recognise that they have an opportunity to reflect further on the draft order in the course of scrutinising the remedial order, and the committee envisages taking that opportunity. So I welcome Angela Constance, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning, and with her, I believe, we have Nigel Graham, who's the Policy Advisor to Criminal Law and Sentencing, Kevin Gibson, a solicitor in criminal law, police and fire, and Asa Heine, a solicitor in food, children, education, health and social care. It sounds a pretty wide remit to me. And I also welcome along from Disclosure Scotland, Gary Hart, the protection of canoes, the head of protection services. Cabinet Secretary, I understand you have a statement, which of course I would always wish would be short, but under the circumstances may not be, and I understand that, so I invite you to introduce the subject to us, please.
Thank you, Convener, and I'll do my best for brevity. Good morning, colleagues, and thank you for the invitation to attend to answer your questions about the draft affirmative order, the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions Scotland Amendment Order 2015, that we are proposing will form part of the amendments to the system of higher level disclosures in Scotland. Before I briefly explain some background, can I put on record my thanks to Parliament, including a number of parliamentary officials and the business managers who have been very accommodating as we deal with this unusual parliamentary scrutiny process for the draft affirmative order. So let me explain the background, Convener. Higher level disclosure is the phrase used to describe the overall system that allows for additional scrutiny of a person's criminal convictions. It is used, amongst other purposes, where someone wants to work with vulnerable groups, such as, for example, in a nursery, or as a medical professional, or in a school, or where someone wants to work in a sensitive area, such as offering financial advice. These are, of course, just some of the areas where higher level disclosure is used. Firstly, the system operates through the responsibilities of individuals to disclose conviction information. Secondly, the system operates through Disclosure Scotland being able to issue certificates containing conviction information that's held on central police records. And under this system of additional scrutiny, the information which must be disclosed by the individual and Disclosure Scotland includes convictions which have become spent under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act. And this information would not ordinarily be disclosable to an employer, but it is under higher level disclosures. The operation of the two areas of disclosure can be seen as mutually reinforcing, with information given by the individual in, say, completing a job application form able to be checked by an employer against what information is contained in a higher level disclosure, such as a standard or enhanced disclosure certificate or a protecting vulnerable groups, the PVG disclosure issued by Disclosure Scotland. It is helpful to place the higher disclosure system in context. For less sensitive roles, for example, supermarket checkout staff, Parliament has decided that a different level of scrutiny is merited, with people only being required to self-disclose any recent or serious convictions. Once a conviction has become spent under the terms of the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, it will not be disclosed in relation to less sensitive roles. And the changes being proposed only affect the regime of higher level disclosure, and there is no impact for disclosure relating to less sensitive roles. Case law, through various court judgments, has found that the point at which someone's conviction becomes spent is the point at which the information becomes part of a person's private life. And the system of higher level disclosure, which requires disclosure of even spent convictions, therefore requires the disclosure of private information about an individual. In June 2014, the UK Supreme Court found that the system of higher level disclosures, as it operated in England and Wales, breached a person's Article 8 rights under ECHR. And this was because, although the court fully accepted the need for additional scrutiny of a person's background if they wanted to work with vulnerable groups or in a sensitive role, the court indicated that the automatic indiscriminate requirement for disclosure of all spent convictions was not proportionate, as no assessment of the relevance of the information to the need for the disclosure was undertaken. And it was suggested by the court that a proportionate system of disclosure required the necessity of the disclosure to be assessed by reference to the purpose of the disclosure, and the assessment could include, amongst other matters, looking at factors such as age of the conviction, nature of the offence, and age of the offender. So an amended system of higher level disclosure taking account of those factors will be delivered partially by this affirmative order. This affirmative order amends the requirements for self-disclosure by individuals of their spent convictions. Members will already be aware that the reforms to the system of disclosures issued by Disclosure Scotland will be delivered in a forthcoming remedial order under the Convention Rights Compliance Scotland Act 2001, and the remedial order will be subject to separate consultation and parliamentary scrutiny in accordance with the procedures that are set out in that Act. And this amended system will restrict the requirement for disclosure so that not all spent convictions will require to be routinely disclosed. And under the amended system, certain spent convictions become protected convictions which will not be disclosed. Other spent convictions will still require to be disclosed because they will still be relevant for the purposes of the disclosure. The Scottish Government, convener, is focused on ensuring our system of checking the background of people wanting to work with vulnerable groups or in other sensitive roles continues to protect the public. But we must balance that public interest with the rights of individuals to have their private life respected. We consider this legislative package achieves that necessary balance. Once again, I put on record our thanks for the assistance and guidance from Parliament in taking forward this draft affirmative order and, in due course, taking forward the remedial order. And I am aware, convener, that you will have questions about the legal and procedural issues surrounding the orders, and we are happy to answer any questions you have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that probably, Cabinet Secretary, answers my first question as to what problem you were actually trying to solve. It is perhaps helpful for me at this stage just to make the point on the record and to my colleagues that we don't normally consider the policy of instruments in front of us. That normally goes to the relevant policy committee. It's not just because there won't be a policy committee on this occasion, but because the entire purpose of these instruments is to satisfy the European Convention on Human Rights. That I suggest that everything we might want to ask does actually fall within the remit of this committee, because it's got to be made to work, and therefore every policy consideration is relevant to us. And on that basis, I think I'll hand over to John Mason.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder if you could just explain to us maybe something about the timing of this, because I think you said that it was June 2014 was the Supreme Court ruling, and I'm just wondering why it's September 2015 that you've chosen to bring this forward.
Indeed, and it's a fair question, convener. It's important to stress that the UK Supreme Court obviously has a remit across the UK, but they were making a judgment on a situation that had occurred in England and Wales. They were looking at the indiscriminate disclosure of cautions, and obviously in a Scottish context we have alternative to prosecutions and not cautions. And you know, there was no direct easy read over between this judgment and the law as it stands in Scotland. And, of course, the judgment didn't make any comment about Scots law. So we wanted to take the appropriate time to really understand the UK Supreme Court's judgment. And there was also other case law that we wanted to look at as well in terms of in England and Wales and in Northern Ireland. And it's important to stress that irrespective of how long our considerations took in getting to this point, that because of the unique nature and what we're dealing with and what we're trying to do, we would still be, you know, seeking Parliament's cooperation in pursuing matters through this unusual scrutiny and expedited process. And that's because that if we are refining the current system in relation to higher level disclosures, we have to cease the operation of Disclosure Scotland. And Disclosure Scotland do 1,000 higher level disclosures a day, so we need to minimise the disruption that is caused by ceasing activities. So there is an urgency in terms of this matter, but we wanted to give full deliberations to ensure that we were understanding the case law and the UK Supreme Court judgment to make all necessary adjustments in terms of our policy and our practice.
I mean, I totally agree that we should think things through and not be precipitate in our action. I suppose, though, I do wonder, that's 15 months that perhaps issues about people's private lives have been disclosed in contravention, really, to that court ruling.
Well, as I said, it is entirely appropriate for the government to look very closely at the UK Supreme Court judgment. And as I said in my statement, there was not a direct read over into Scots law. Changing the higher level disclosure system is complex and has to be done very, very carefully. And I don't know, Gerry, is there something from a Disclosure Scotland perspective that you would like to add to that?
Well, I would think that the issue that that you've raised about the period of time that it took to comprehensively understand the implications of the UKSE judgment on Scots law is very, very important, because the Scottish Parliament isn't, of course, competent to act outside ECHR. It wasn't simply the case that we could simply look at the disclosure aspects. We had to look and review the policy across the, you know, the PPG Act, the Police Act and the ROA Act to identify potential areas for incompatibility right through the depth of the legislation, and that took time. It also took time to devise and implement an operational solution within Disclosure Scotland that was capable of applying the amended regime and generating the disclosures in a way which was safe for the public in terms of disclosing the right information to employers and to other interested parties, as well as to balance fairness and make sure they're accurate for individuals who are requesting disclosures. That took a number of months to do and involved some quite complicated work within Disclosure Scotland. So all of that together added up to the period of time that's been taken.
Do we know when England and Wales changed their system?
Yes, the England and Wales changed their system prior to the UKSC judgment. However, there has been case law since then, particularly in Northern Ireland recently, which suggests that there may be some question marks over whether the English and Welsh system is as compliant with ECHR as we would certainly wish the Scottish system to be. So we really had to take cognizance of that case law developing and make sure that the Scottish system was fully compliant.
Okay, thanks, Camilla.
Okay, sorry. Can I just bring Stuart
in? We will go to
Jim. Just a technical point. Could perhaps the Cabinet Secretary repeat her statement about the high-level disclosures that are giving the per annum figure?
Ah, yes. In terms of the daily figure.
Yes.
Yeah.
I heard you say something which took me by surprise, and I want you to be very clear as to what the number is.
For every day that Disclosure Scotland is not issuing higher level disclosures, that is 1,000 disclosures a day not being issued. And in terms of this parliamentary process, that means for 3 days, Disclosure Scotland will not be issuing higher level disclosures, so that's 3,000. So you will appreciate why we have pursued a more expedited parliamentary scrutiny process for very, I hope committee agrees, very good and practical reasons.
Thank you, Kevin. It was just a higher number than I expected to hear, and I wanted to hear it said again.
Indeed, it does actually seem a very surprisingly large number, I think, to us, but if that's the case, then so be it. John, did you want to pursue that?
Essentially, developing that question, nonetheless, are there any other reasons for the need to make this such a swift process, 15 months to consider it, 2 days to scrutinise it? I appreciate the figure of 3,000 or 1,000 people a day, but are there any other reasons why this has to be done swiftly other than that, or is that the sole reason?
Well, it is important that we have public confidence in our disclosure system, and that's why the system ceases operating while we move to a more refined system of higher level disclosures. While we are in the process of making changes, it would not be appropriate in terms of issuing disclosures on the basis of the system before it was amended or refined. Committee might be interested to know that Disclosure Scotland is 1.2 million disclosures a year. And it's I note committee's questioning around the 15 months lead up to this point, but it may be of interest to the committee that the UK Supreme Court did express some surprise in its decision that legislation for England and Wales had been made in advance of the UK Supreme Court decision. So I think given the complexities and that the case in question didn't have a direct read over into Scots law, and that judgment by the UK Supreme Court didn't make any recommendations or comment on Scots law, we, as outlined by myself and officials, had to undertake, you know, quite a complex piece of work and period of investigation and to review our current system. And we're now, as a result of that review, coming to Parliament with proposed changes. Maybe in terms of process, convener, while this affirmative order is going through a 3-day process, as I intimated in my statement, there are two mutually reinforcing aspects of the disclosure system. They're the responsibilities of the individual, which is what the affirmative order is about, and the compliance order, which will be laid on Thursday, is in relation to the responsibilities of Disclosure Scotland. And in essence, the responsibilities of the state and the responsibilities of the individual have to be complementary and have to be married up in terms of the disclosure system. And the system, the new proposed system, can't come into place until
Both the affirmative order, which we're discussing today, and the compliance order come into force, and they have to come into force on the same day. And the point I'm getting to, convener, and I apologise for the length of this, is that once the compliance order is laid, that there is a period of scrutiny for 120 days where you know, there's a period for written considerations, and there is the opportunity for the relevant policy committees to be writing reports, and then a statement will have to be laid in Parliament. And then if changes are deemed necessary to be made, after that point they can be made, and we would then have to come back and amend the affirmative order. So there is a process of scrutiny attached with all this.
Thank you.
Okay. Just in relation to the figure you've quoted, and you also outlined in your correspondence about 1,000 higher level disclosures a day, in terms of the changes that are being proposed, how will that number be affected? Has there been any assessment made of the number of disclosures we now expect with the new proposals that are before us?
The number of anticipated disclosures we wouldn't expect to change. This is about moving to a system where the decision-making process around what is disclosed to an employer is more proportionate and reflects the learning that has taken place following the UK Supreme Court judgment.
Before we move on to alternatives, can I just bring Stuart in?
I note what the Cabinet Secretary said on decision-making process. It does appear that, depending on the circumstances of the request for a higher level disclosure, there will now need to be some assessment as to what's put in it in relation particularly to Schedule B1, and we'll come in more detail to that later. My question is a really very simple one. It would be important to get this on the record. How well prepared are Disclosure Scotland for what, at least at this stage of our questioning, would appear to be a more complex environment for Disclosure Scotland that may, you know, increase the workload there? How well prepared are we? And has the preparation for those changes been part of what has justified the amount of time that one might suggest it's taken to get to this point?
Yeah, and that's a pragmatic point, because the system as it stands just now, all spent convictions are disclosed under higher level disclosures. So, you know, there's a simplicity to that. And we're moving to a system where, you know, some very minor issues are not disclosed. There will always be some spent convictions that will always be disclosed, and then there is a list of offences
Do forgive me, Cabinet Secretary, I think we'll come to that detail a little bit later. I really just want to be sure that I would like to hear that Disclosure Scotland are prepared for that additional complexity in their decision making.
Yes, and just now, Mr. Stevenson, there is a standard, a target, if you like, for to complete disclosure applications, and that's 14 days. That's for 90% of correctly completed applications to be completed within 14 days, and we are confident that given this new, this amended or more refined system, that that target and that standard can still be met.
Okay, thank you. I think we will come back to that if we may, Mr. Kelly, think on alternatives.
Yeah, I'll come to my kind of substantive point in a minute. I just want to go back to the answer you gave previously in relation to the 1,000 higher level disclosures a day, and you said that would not change. And I understand there's a balance to be struck here between complying with ECHR and ensuring that the rights of organisations who Disclosure Scotland have got to provide these disclosures to are protected. But if the effect of this is that a number of spent convictions which are currently disclosed will not now be disclosed, how can you be confident that we're still going to have the same number of disclosures?
I think, as I intimated, Mr. Kelly, it's the decisions in and around what is disclosed to an employer. People will still have to make their applications. But I don't know, Gerry, do you want to say a wee bit more about the Disclosure Scotland process?
Yeah, indeed. The number of disclosures is driven by the activity in the marketplace for new workers coming into regulated work, changing jobs. There's a frictional movement, and that drives the number of applications we receive for disclosure. And currently, and for the last couple of years, we've been doing a thing called retrospection, which is bringing on the existing regulated workforce into the PVG scheme, you know, in large numbers. And that actual period is coming to an end very shortly. But that is the main drumbeat for driving the number of applications. A distinct point is what's actually on the disclosure, and that's what's being impacted here. The incidence of the disclosure shouldn't be affected. It's what's on it that's affected. So employers might, after this change is made, expect to see for minor, aged and irrelevant convictions less information disclosed than would have been the case under the pre-amended regime. However, the balance has to be struck, and we've tried to do that in policy, between what is information that an employer really must see in terms of the safeguarding imperative, which continues to drive, you know, the ethos of the disclosure regime, balancing that against the individual's rights to have their past conduct where it's no longer relevant to the kind of work that they're seeking to do.
That's a point which we are going to come to probably in some detail in a minute, because it's obviously relevant. I wonder if I can persuade James to move on to the alternative, please, because we will come back
to some of the related points in that. Just in terms of, it's obviously been 15 months since the Supreme Court ruling. What was your logic in not going down the route of primary legislation?
I'm going to ask Ailsa, the lawyer.
Well, I mean, one of the main reasons for not opting for primary legislation was the provisions in relation to the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act and the amendments to the 2013 order couldn't have been made in a bill because of the powers that we have under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act. There's a Scotland Act order that gives us powers to make provision in the exclusions and exceptions order about reserved areas. And that's the only way that we can make those changes. That wouldn't have been possible in a bill, because it would have been outside competence. So while it would have been possible perhaps to do the provisions that are in the remedial order in a bill, there would have still been a requirement for two pieces of legislation that needed to operate and come into force in tandem. So given that the powers that existed in the Convention Rights Compliance Act, it was felt that that would be the appropriate way of making the changes in relation to the Police Act and the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Act.
I understand the process point you make, but from a parliamentary point of view, obviously primary legislation would have given Parliament, you know, a much longer time to scrutinise what is clearly a significant piece of work. Was that something that was taken into account?
Yeah, I mean, it was taken into account. I think in considering a bill, then we felt that it would have really needed to have been a fairly expedited process for a bill in this, because of the requirements to maintain public confidence in the system of disclosure as the changes were being made. So that we considered that with the remedial order, the changes could be made and then there would be certainty as to what the law required, and there's still a period of public consultation after that, after which we can reflect and consider if any changes need to be made to the remedial order.
Okay, convener.
John Scott, please.
Convener, the approach adopted will mean then that the processes for higher level disclosures will change as soon as the order and remedial order are made. presumably as yet unprocessed cases requiring a disclosure will be dealt with under the new scheme. Can you confirm that that will be the case, please?
Yes, I mean, Disclosure Scotland will cease the operation for 3 working days of higher level disclosures, and those 3,000 applications that have not been processed will be processed under the new scheme, and there are arrangements in place for Disclosure Scotland to be working out with its normal working hours to ensure that our standard of 90% of correctly completed applications are met within 14 days.
Is it, forgive me for asking, is it just 3,000? I mean, that's the 3 working days that we envisage there being a blank space, but are there other applications in the pipeline that will also add to that figure of 3,000 or not?
I checked this morning, and the numbers that are awaiting processing are well within the parameters that we've set out. So there will not be a bigger backlog than we have said, and it will be processed efficiently and expedited as quickly as we can. We have resources lined up in place, ready to go when the law changes.
Thank you.
I think we're about to come to a series of questions that relate to the substance of the proposals that you have. Before we get there, though, I'm just wondering if I could just go back to process, and in particular the process of disclosure and of operating that unit. Because, as you've already indicated, Cabinet Secretary, up to now it's been essentially quite clear this is in that category, that is in that category, this is in that category. You either disclose it or you don't. Once these orders are through, then you'll be in a position where there will still be the outliers, but there will be the section in the middle which requires some kind of judgment to be made. Now, on the basis that it's 1,000 a day, that cannot clearly be 1,000 coming to the head of the unit for a discretionary view. Manifestly, that's not going to happen. So presumably there is somewhere or other some kind of written down flowchart paradigm that says this is the basis on which you operate, presumably in the hope there's a very, very small number that really do need managerial discretion. Is that document something that you would be sharing with Parliament in the process?
I convener, wouldn't describe it as a system that involves managerial discretion. I mean, what we are seeking approval from Parliament to do is to agree a set of rules in which higher level disclosure operates under. And once the compliance order is laid, there is that 120-day period for people to express their opinion on the rules as proposed by the Scottish Government. The only, area that I would highlight is that the police currently have the powers to disclose information that they see as relevant and pertinent, even if it's information that they have that has not led to a conviction. And that power remains unchanged. And that's a power that the police have. But we are revising, if you like, a system of rules in relation to disclosures, and that's what requires parliamentary scrutiny and approval of.
John. Ask a supplementary to what you've just asked, which, am I understanding correctly that, relevance to the employment becomes more of an issue than it has been, and that's where I would have thought there was going to be some kind of managerial input to decide, you know, if it's in the financial area, is it a finance director, is it a accountant mid-tier, is it a cashier? Would there not be more judgment in there?
Because I think we've probably used the wrong word. Can I say, I don't think this is management, I think this is administrative as a matter of legal term. You know, this is administrative law, essentially, we're dealing with. This is not management. But there's nonetheless surely going to be an administrative decision which will be made by somebody in Disclosure Scotland as to what the relevance of something is.
Well, the operational process and the administrative decisions are based on the rules as laid down by Parliament. And individuals can, of course, under certain circumstances, challenge the application of those rules via the Sheriff Court. But, I mean, this is a regulated process. And in terms of Mr. Mason's question, I suppose, if you can bear with me, convener, in terms of, you know, types of jobs, it's recognised already by Parliament that types of jobs require specific levels of disclosure. So that's where the issues of particular types of employment, so for example, doctor, teacher, social worker, nurse, you know, require to be part of the PVG scheme. You know, prison officers, people who work in young offenders institutes, members of prison visiting committees, you know, would be part of an enhanced disclosure schemes. You know, financial services is part of a standard disclosure scheme. So that part of the system already exists.
So it's not becoming more complex.
It is becoming more complex, and that's why we're coming to Parliament with a series of rules. And I don't know if when you want to explore this further, convener, you know, there will be a list of offences that will always be disclosed, and there will be a list of offences that
I'm
will,
just about to that, ask you about that in my next question.
That will be disclosed depending on the age at the time the conviction was received, how long ago the conviction was, and obviously, you know, the nature of the offence is reflected in the sense that there are two separate lists, and there's a small amount of very minor offences that wouldn't be disclosed that are always protected. So that would be things like littering. Motoring offences that are related to, you know, the lights on your car, you know, drunkenness, you know, they would, you know, if they're spent and they would just not be disclosed. And you have these two substantive lists of things that are always disclosed and those that may be disclosed. And that will depend on when the you know, the age of the offender at the time and how long ago, you know, the conviction was and what the offence was for.
I think you've just taken us to that part of the agenda. Okay. I think John Mason's the man who will be continuing to test.
Yes, this is the kind of real question. The last one was supplementary. Okay. But just if you could give us some background as the considerations that were given about the choice of offences. We've got the two schedules here, Schedule A1, mm-hmm. Offences which must always be disclosed, and Schedule B1, offences which are to be disclosed subject to the rules. So could you give us some reasoning why one group is as it is and the other is as it is?
Yeah, and this, of course, committee will appreciate is a complex area, an area that, you know, we needed to give great thought to. Obviously, a murder conviction is never spent, so it's always disclosed. Offences that will be in Schedule 8A of the compliance order and offences that are in A1 of the affirmative order are offences like assault to severe injury, assault with intent to rape or ravage, culpable homicide, extortion and rape. And then there are an other list of offences that, you know, things like breach of the peace, you know, culpable and reckless conduct, where, you know, those offences, depending on the age of the offender at the time of the offence and how long ago the conviction was, may not be disclosed. So if someone at the age of 19 was convicted of a breach of the peace and 15 years had elapsed since the time of that conviction, they would not have that spent conviction would not have to be disclosed. If they were under the age of 18, 7.5 years would have to elapse before that spent conviction would not be disclosed.
Okay. I think we're clear that, you know, things like murder, rape are obviously serious, and some of the others you mentioned, breach of the peace, might not be so much. I suppose it's when it comes down to the kind of dividing line, mm-hmm. it becomes tricky. And I see one of the ones which must be disclosed is uttering threats, and one of the ones which may not be disclosed is perjury. Mm-hmm. Now, for a lot of people, perjury is a pretty serious offence. How did you distinguish between that?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, we've looked at a wide range of information. We've looked at multiple sources of information. So you'll see we have been busy since the UK Supreme Court judgment. We've obviously looked at the classification of crimes and offences, every type of offence recorded in the children's hearing system, the police national computer, the disclosure and barren service. We've looked at Northern Ireland's filtering list as well. And in terms of our approach, I mean, we're looking at offences that have resulted in serious harm to a person, a significant breach of trust and responsibility, offences that have demonstrated exploitative or coercive behaviour, dishonesty against an individual, offences that where people have abused a position of trust, or a degree of recklessness. So these are the things that we've been looking at when those, and that's why, we have those two lists of things that either will be disclosed or may be disclosed, and our thinking is informed by these factors, because all of these factors that I've mentioned, are of relevance or potentially of relevance to those offences on both lists. And I suppose ultimately there is 120 days of post-compliance order scrutiny, and stakeholders and parliamentarians may well have views about the rules that we're trying to establish, and that's a very important part of that process, will be to receive the written considerations, to receive the committee reports. A further statement will have to be made in Parliament, and if necessary, further changes will be made. So we're coming with what we believe to be a solution to the issues at hand, but that doesn't mean there can't be further reflection upon the detail, whether that detail is exactly as it should be.
Okay, so this is, given the timescales and everything, this is the proposal in a sense, and we're going along with that, but that doesn't mean it's fixed in stone for no, ages and ages.
We are confident, given that we've taken the time to explore the matters inside out. We've taken the time to ensure that from a policy perspective and operationally in terms of the demands of Disclosure Scotland, we're confident that this is the right solution. But you're quite correct, Mr Mason, it is not set in stone, and there is a very important part of the process, and I can assure you a willingness on behalf of the government to be very acute and listen acutely to the concerns of parliamentarians and stakeholders.
Thank you.
Being on the record quite clearly that, and I think we respect the judgments that you've just made, the law will change on Thursday, and that will be the law for the time being, as it always will be.
Yes.
Thank you. That's fair enough. James, would you like to pick up your...
Sure. How confident are you that you've got the balance right here between the public interests and the rights of private individuals when there's been no public consultation, no consultation with parliamentarians?
I mean, we are confident, as you highlighted, Mr Kelly, we've taken 15 months in our considerations. But as I said to Mr Mason, we will be acutely listening to parliamentarians' views tomorrow and in the 120-day post-legislative scrutiny. We acknowledge that this is an unusual procedure that we are following, but I just personally want to assure committee that we are pursuing this unusual procedure because we feel we're absolutely sure of the necessity to do so.
Right, thank you. I think it's back to John. Yes, thank you.
If I'm understanding the proposals correctly, the system is that under the remedial order envisages that a draft certificate containing a conviction can be appealed to the sheriff, provided that's done within 6 months of notifying Disclosure Scotland of the intention to do so. Now, obviously, if somebody does choose to make that appeal, there's going to be a time lapse between the request for disclosure, the certificate being eventually issued, which would suggests to me that the employer is going to be very suspicious that there is something going on in the background. Is there some way of preventing that or protecting against that? Because almost by the fact that the employer gets nothing back suggests that there's something hidden.
Mm-hmm. Jay, did you want to address the six-month issue?
Yes, I mean, the issue there, of course, is the potential to interfere with a person's Article 8 rights whenever you send the second certificate to the employer. If there was something on that disclosure that shouldn't have been there, then by sending that to the employer, you have effectively interfered with the person's Article 8 rights, and that's precisely the policy intention behind this, to make sure there's no potential for that to happen. So I think neither situation is ideal. You know, the delay in the individual's employer receiving the certificate will, as you say, flag up, you know, a potential for concern there. But whilst you have a system of having two disclosures issuing to the individual and to the employer, a system which our feedback tells us is greatly valued by employers across the country, there has to be a compromise struck between whether or not, you know, you issue one or not, and when you withhold that, what's the greater evil? Is it to send it out and interfere with a person's Article 8 rights, or is it to withhold it and not do that, but to leave this potential for uncertainty around what the employer might deduce from that? So we've decided in policy terms that is the only appropriate response that we could possibly make, because it would be simply unacceptable to interfere with Article 8 rights or potentially do so, and that's the reason for that policy decision.
I mean, I do understand the dilemma you've got. I'm just wondering how it's going to work out in practice, because nothing comes back to the employer. The employer does not offer the job to the person. I just wonder if the person then has a claim against Disclosure Scotland or could try that.
But, I mean, in terms of someone making, let's just say, a new disclosure application, the fact that they get their certificate before the employer, and then there is 10 days to appeal to the sheriff. Now, that's quite a tight time frame. I appreciate, you know, that, you know, any delay may be, you know, undesirable, but there has to be, you know, some gap. And by, you know, the individual receiving, you know, the disclosure information first, it does give them that opportunity, you know, to appeal to the sheriff within 10 days. Mm-hmm. And, of course, that, you know, 10 days is sitting within the 14-day target of 90% of applications completed, if they're correctly completed in the first place.
OK, thank you.
So does that mean, then, that if I make an application for a relevant job, you would want to turn around my potential disclosure to me in 4 days, so I've got 10 days to appeal it before you meet your 14 days to my employer or potential employer? Is that that seems unlikely, that's why I'm asking the question.
We wouldn't tie it up like that. I mean, the individual will receive their disclosure, and they will know that there's been spent convictions disclosed, if that's happened.
Yep.
And they will then have a period of 10 working days thereafter to intimate an intention to appeal. They don't actually have to make the appeal in that 10 days. Yep. They just have to tell us that they're going to do that. And at that point, we'll not issue this other employer certificate. But these cases are so few in number that they couldn't really impact on our general attainment of our 14 days 90% service level agreement, or target, if you like. However, we still have the spirit of that target to meet, and we will strive to do that. It's in the individual's gift to tell us if they want to intimate an appeal or not, and if they don't, then it will all issue in the normal fashion, but they'll still have that 10 days to make their mind up.
So everyone who receives such a disclosure will know that they've got 10 working days, effectively 2 weeks, to appeal, and they know that their potential employer will not have received a disclosure form until that 2 weeks is up.
Yes.
Regardless of where we are in this aspirational 14 days.
Yes.
Yes. Right. Thank you. I think that's clear. Thank you.
Yes, and just to say, convener, that, you know, I concur with Jerry's characterisation of the process. I think I was perhaps a bit over simplistic in how I articulated it.
No, that's okay. I understand that. And I also do recognise we're dealing with relatively small numbers here. They're not probably going to impact on the statistics. But as always, as parliamentarians, we'll worry about the individual, and the statistics take care of themselves. I think at that point, I'm probably going on to John Scott. Is that right?
Thank you, Convener. And before I come to the question, I want to ask quite specifically, can I just ask in the general sense, given that it's 15 months since the Supreme Court judgment, are there any people who will feel themselves to have been disadvantaged in the meantime in terms of the law being changed in England and Wales prior to the judgment and elsewhere since? And I just wonder if it was unreasonable or if it's reasonable for people to feel that they may have been disadvantaged in the interim.
It is, of course, reasonable, given that there was no direct readout between the UK Supreme Court judgment and Scots law, you know, for the government to be taken, you know, action. But, I mean, we're not saying that the existing system is non-compliant. I mean, ultimately, it's for the courts that decide these matters. But we do, of course, want to ensure that our system is as robust as possible in light of UK Supreme Court judgments, other case law. You know, so we want to, as much as we can, without things being tested in court, ensure that our processes are ECHR compliant and that we're getting the right balance and that public protection is at the heart of everything we do.
Okay, which takes me nicely into the next question I want to ask. And in relation to non-protected Schedule B1 convictions, the policy note says that the starting point is that such convictions will be included on higher level disclosure certificates. Is it the intention for Disclosure Scotland to have discretion regarding the inclusion of such convictions, for example, to take into account the nature of the offence and its relevance to the employment or the post applied for? Or will the discretion operate only at the level of the sheriff's consideration where the individual subject to the conviction chooses to apply to the sheriff court for removal of entries relating to such convictions?
I mean, I'm not a lawyer.
Where will the discretion lie?
So let me explain it in terms of how I understand it. Disclosure Scotland are not operating a discretionary scheme. The scheme is set out by the rules that are ultimately approved by Parliament. Of course, people can take matters to a sheriff and, you know, they look at the situation in terms of the existing law. But maybe ask Gerry to say a bit more about that.
Yes, I mean, the policy that determines whether or not something is or isn't disclosed is still a policy decision that ministers have made, but it is set out and codified in a way which is applicable in the same way across different cases. The UK Supreme Court ruling in 2014 set out that there was a number of tests that a reasonable person might apply to think about whether something should or shouldn't be disclosed. And the rules that are set out by ministers tries to accommodate those tests, to try and apply those tests in a coherent and rational way. However, we understand that there will always be cases where the circumstances of the case, which is one of the tests that the court flagged up, are such that in that particular instance, it wouldn't be right to disclose that. And that's why we've made the provision for the individual to be able to go and make their case to a sheriff to take account specially of those unusual circumstances or particular background factors that mean in that particular instance the general policy rules shouldn't apply in this may or may not disclose rules list of offences. So that's the thinking behind it. The rules will be applied in a very black and white way. However, whenever you have a disclosure of something which is a spent conviction on the rules list, often the way that the offences are codified on police systems, they occur together in a single string of narrative. And in those cases, we will disclose the matters around at the same diet, that matter being convicted. So that's why there's a sort of caveat in the words, if I think I've picked you up correctly from your question. It's not that the rules will be applied in a discretionary way by Disclosure Scotland or that somebody will sit and make a judgment of Solomon about whether something should or shouldn't be disclosed. That won't happen. The only person in this process who will have that discretionary role will be a sheriff, ultimately. And the rules will be applied otherwise.
And so, for the avoidance of doubt, there will be no discretion available
to you?
No.
No. It will be solely through the court?
Yes.
Thank you.
Right, thank you. I think I now turn to Stuart Stevenson.
Yes, and I'm going to start off with an incredibly naive question. When I look at Schedule B1, which is headed offences which are to be disclosed subject to rules, my question is, where are the rules?
Hmm. Well, the rules, Mr. Stevenson, are at what age was the individual at the time of the offence? I will ask Jerry to talk about the more technical aspect, but in terms of plain speaking, you know, I think we can clearly distill the rules into the age of the individual at the time of their offence, were they over or under 18? How long ago was the offence committed or convicted? How long ago was the conviction? You know, was it 15 years ago or was it 7.5 years ago? And the time frame depends on the age of the offender. And in terms of the nature of the offence, that's obviously reflected in the fact that there are two schedules. But in terms of where are the rules, I'll ask Jerry to explain that, because it's more about policy.
Well, the rules are as the Cabinet Secretary set out, they are simple rules. They are for this middle group.
I wonder if I might just intervene,
of course,
to explain. I understood the timeline and the two different lists, and that's a set of rules. But we have in evidence had reference to, and I'm going to create my own example. Item 9, for example, in Schedule B1 is embezzlement. Clearly, that's going to be an important matter to disclose if the employment that's relating to the disclosure request is in the financial services industry. But it might not matter if it was in the care sector in the same way. And I got the sense in what some of the previous evidence has said that if it's an application related to financial services, then of the things on B1, as a matter of rule, you would have a list of which would be disclosed in a financial services and a different list that relates to the care sector. And I'm getting nodding heads from witnesses in relation to that distinction between the different employments and which of B1 will therefore be disclosed as a matter of rule, as distinct from the court ruling and people applying, where are those rules?
I mean, we have, you know, considered these issues. I'm going to ask Ailsa to pick up on your example.
In relation to where the rules are contained, they're contained in the definition of what will become protected convictions. And that's set out in both the affirmative order and also will be contained in the Police Act as amended by the remedial order. So it sets out what is a protected conviction by reference to the rules that are set out in, sorry, reference to the offences which are listed in the two schedules.
I wonder if the witnesses might just help me by pointing me at the relevant page in what's in front of the committee. Not that I want to explore it in detail, I merely wish to know where they are. And my reading of it as a layperson didn't lead me to understand the answer to that question.
So in terms of the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act Amendment Order, the Exclusions and Exceptions Amendment Order, the definition of protected convictions is in Article 2, on page 2 of the order. And that is the crux of where the rules are contained about.
Sorry, do forgive me.
No, I realise it's complicated. So it's,
well, that's so, why I'm asking.
So page 2 of the,
yes,
of the order, amending the Exclusions and Exceptions Order, sets out a definition of protected convictions.
No, I've got that, and it goes on to insert a section 2A. But in particular, there is some reference to Children's Hearing Scotland Act on the following page and so on and so forth. But I got the sense from previous evidence that what would be provided from the menu, and I'll call it that informally, that is Schedule B1, if it was someone operating in the financial services, that some would be chosen and some would be not. I may be being hopelessly naive in my question, but I get the sense my colleagues are with me on this one.
Well, these rules are intended to apply across the whole spectrum of higher level disclosures. There's not a distinction made depending on the job or the purpose for the disclosure. The rules apply across the board.
So therefore, just to be clear and to make it simple enough for even me to understand, that all the things that are in B1, the process by which Disclosure Scotland will work, all offences that are covered by B1 will normally be disclosed. Right, that's helpful, because I've possibly confused myself when I was listening to some of the previous evidence into imagining that there was some difference. So the distinction will be made when the person about whom the disclosure is being made suggests, for the sake of argument, that they're working in the care industry, that a disclosure about an embezzlement might not be necessary. So that is when, mm-hmm. and the only time, when matters in B1 are removed from the disclosure certificate.
Yes, but there's a slight bit of additional information that would be worth sharing with you, which is that when it comes to the post-specific aspects of what you're asking about, the Chief Constable has powers to give information in that way, in enhanced
disclosure. But that's non-conviction information, yes. Which we heard about yes. earlier, and I understand it. Right, now that's very helpful, and that simplifies things.
Can I just add from over here that was the basis of my question about administrative discretion? If you're telling me that the rules are, in a sense, that simple, that black and white, that I think takes away my earlier discussion about who might be making these kind of decisions, because it sounds as though they're not going to be made. Stuart, please.
Right. we'll now move on to some more detailed matters, but I couldn't ask the other questions they've suggested ask without understanding that, to be blunt about it, so do forgive me. And I suppose the first of the question is the hard cases rule, and looking in particular at item 4 on Schedule B, which is a breach of the peace, which is one of these very, very wide common law offences, which ranges from up to quite severe things and down to matters relatively trivial. And when you might have somebody who's under 18, who's 1 month short of the 7.5 years that would exclude it, I take it then that really the only way in which that's excluded, you just confirm in that context what I've heard, will be for the individual concerned to appeal and go to the Sheriff Court. There is no other way of doing that, and it's not within the remit of Disclosure Scotland. Right, okay, I think we've covered that, so I don't need to spend more time with that. However, the next one's a bit more substantial, in that Article 3 of the draft order makes a distinction between judicial proceedings in which spent convictions may be protected, but other tribunals and hearings where there is no such provision. And there appears in what's before us to be no provision for going to the Sheriff Court to say that something on B1 not be disclosed when somebody's in front of a tribunal and is asked to disclose. Is that the policy intention that the government has, or is that something in the drafting that has led to that difference in these different contexts? In other words, there are contexts in which there appears to be no legal provision for things on Schedule B1 not to be disclosed.
I'm going to restrain into some of Kevin's territory, so I'm going to ask you to reply to that, because it's a good point.
Yeah, well, the starting point is that convictions which are on the B1 list will always be admissible in the proceedings which are not listed there. That's to say they cannot become protected.
May I just immediately come in and say, yes, I understand that, and that's why I'm asking the question. Why is there that distinction that in certain contexts, the whole of B1, there's no provision for something being deleted? Why is that different from the disclosure to an employer?
There are two sort of separate categories of proceedings that we're talking about here. One category is proceedings where what is relevant or disclosable in those proceedings is set out in a separate context. So we're talking in particular about firearms proceedings, proceedings under the Gambling Act. The founding legislation which sets up those proceedings describes what is relevant in terms of conviction information in the context of those proceedings. And all the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act is doing in relation to that is ensuring that the policy that is delivered in relation to those particular areas is not upset by things becoming spent and therefore not disclosable in those proceedings.
So the view is being taken that because there's a comparatively narrow focus that's already in legislation and is very specific, that it is not breaching the private rights of individuals under Article 8 under those circumstances because, in the context of a firearms certificate or a gambling licence or whatever, the judgment that the government's making is that that's not breaching Article 8.
Yes, I mean, two things about that, I suppose. One is that many of the proceedings that fall into that category are proceedings in reserved areas, and we couldn't really affect the policy decision that's been taken by the UK government about what is relevant in relation to applications for gambling licences, for example. But the second element to that is that...
Do forgive me, I'm going to come in. You're not raising a red herring here. You're not saying you would legislate if we had the powers.
They're already restricted under other legislation. So the Gambling Act 2005 says that there are certain types of convictions, spent convictions, that need to be disclosed. So that's set out in that legislation. So to actually then have a different type of disclosure in this wouldn't actually make sense because you've already got restricted disclosure. So you wouldn't be breaching ECHR because it's restricted already through the Gambling Act.
Yeah, I was just picking up the virus issue that had been raised there, that notwithstanding would be ultra-virus, there's no suggestion that you would want to legislate in areas that we're not competent to legislate in any way. We don't need to go any further than that.
I think the second element just to pick up on is that the people who take the judicial authorities who determine what is admissible or not admissible in these proceedings will in large part be public authorities with their own ECHR obligations to respect. And the view that we've taken is that where it is somebody else who has a decision as to whether a conviction or private information is admissible or not is a public authority, then it's right to allow them to exercise their discretion in that area.
So what we're saying is that this court judgment, which is the spring for why we're here at all, is something that a number of public bodies will need to take account of when they have people appearing in front of a range of bodies that they're responsible for. But will that extend to the people who are appearing in front of those bodies, understanding that they're not required to disclose things?
There are two aspects to disclosure. There's the disclosure aspect, but secondly, the reliance that's placed on the disclosure. And I think that's where the responsibility of the public bodies comes into play. They would not be in a position to rely on irrelevant private information to an individual's prejudice.
Right. So just to close that one off, and I'm conscious I may be going off piece to a substantial extent here, is the government going to ensure that bodies that are going to have to take account of this case in England and Wales, to which we are now responding in a Scottish context, are made aware of the implications that there may be for them and it will be for them to consider so that we don't have a gap in what they're doing? I mean, everything, we're doing something, but there are things beyond that in other parts of public policy and practice. And I just want to be sure that the government is making sure that that's drawn to their attention.
Yes, I mean, we've had discussion with various bodies on that point.
Yep. Okay, sorry, I've quite extensive notes here, which I want just to... And because I've covered a range of...
John, yes, please.
In the meantime, can I just ask a pretty basic question? Are there any cost implications for businesses, companies about this or not? It's probably my inability to have read all the paperwork in time, but I'm not aware if that has been discussed or not, but it'd be helpful to know if indeed there are any cost implications. There's no sort of financial memorandum attached to this, is there? Or is there?
I mean, there is the quality impact assessment and the BREEA, but I mean, there's no additional cost to businesses and individuals over and above what there already currently is. Obviously, in terms of, you know, when you refine a system, there are organisational costs, you know, in and around that. But I mean, you know, they're manageable, and there is obviously the cost to individuals if they choose to appeal. You know, there is that cost.
James, did you?
Yeah, sorry, I do want to go back to Schedule B1. I know my colleagues are reassured, but I still have some queries around that. Just what we do is run through a kind of practical example. So, point 18, public indecency. Someone's got a conviction on that. In the first instance, that's got to be included on the certificate. What would be the scenario or the circumstances which would take that off the disclosure certificate?
Well, the rules, if you like, which we've established are black and white. You know, this isn't Disclosure Scotland exercising, you know, personal discretion. Obviously touch upon, you know, the age of the individual at the time of the public indecency, and in terms of how many years have elapsed. And thereafter, it would be for the individual, if that was on the record and they weren't satisfied about that, that they could appeal to the sheriff. I'm just checking with colleagues that I've not missed anything.
No,
the disposal in the case would also be relevant. So if the person had received an admonition or an absolute discharge for that offence, then it wouldn't ever appear once it was a spent conviction.
I understand that, but if there's a conviction, it appears on the, if you like, the draft certificate. And then it's shown to the person, and they then get they've then got the facility to appeal that.
As long as it fulfils the requirement, you know, of the 15 years, and it appears on the disclosure as a spent conviction, they would have to go to the sheriff and explain what the circumstances were or the particular context was behind that offence in order for the sheriff to be satisfied that it shouldn't thereafter be disclosed.
But it's not the case that in the first instance it would be on the certificate. If in examining some of these rules in terms of the age of the person, the length of the time since the conviction, etc., if that had fallen out with those timescales, then it wouldn't be included on the certificate. It would simply not be there.
Yeah, I mean, if it was a public indecency conviction when the individual was at the age of 19, and then, you know, 15 years have elapsed, it is not disclosed. If it is less than 15 years, it is disclosed, the individual can take that to the sheriff. I should add that, you know, employers, on receipt of information, and we know that some offences, you know, whether it's breach of the peace or, you know, some sort of public indecency, you know, they're quite broad offences. They can capture quite a range of behaviours, and it is therefore, you know, up to the employer, you know, if they see, all right, breach of the peace offence or public indecency, they can ask the individual more information about that, and the individual can speak about that. And in some instances, I mean, it's a decision for the employer. The employer may say, well, that was, you know, 14 years ago, and, you know, they've given an explanation and they've been of good behaviour. So I suppose where there's discretion, in some cases, not in all cases, would be for some employers.
It's also worth mentioning that if that conviction was the vetting information on the individual, that would come up to the Protection Service as part of Disclosure Scotland, who would be able to make a decision as to whether it may be appropriate to consider that individual for barring in either the children's or the adults list or both. And whilst that information is presented to Disclosure Scotland, they would make that decision routinely and do currently on those kinds of cases. So there is an extra safeguard in the system, which is the purpose of barring under PVG.
But am I right in saying that there would be certain public indecency offences which would be disclosed automatically under the current system, which may not under the new proposals?
Check to the rules having been applied and the time having elapsed that's necessary, then yes, that offence, forgive me, I can't recall the precise details of all the lists, but if that offence is on the rules list, if you like, then that would be one that would not be disclosed after the relevant period of time had elapsed.
And is that ask the Cabinet Secretary specifically, is that are you comfortable with that? Is that a matter of concern?
Well, I think, you know, I mean, I'm a former forensic social worker. You know, I have certainly, when you look, you know, at the offences that may be disclosed, of course, there is a range of offences that, as an individual, you know, would always cause concern. But I think in terms of the PVG system, in terms of particular roles, you know, there is that added security of the PVG system that places individuals with, you know, some sort of, like, let's just for argument's sake, say public indecency, that they could be put on the list of barred individuals. You know, none of this is entirely comfortable to us as individuals. But as, you know, the government, we are, you know, front and centre, you know, it's about public protection. But we have to learn from case law and the UK Supreme Court judgment to ensure that our system is more proportionate, if you like. So, you know, there are offences that will always be disclosed, and there are offences that will be disclosed, you know, up until 15 years, obviously less if the individual was younger or under 18 at the time of the conviction.
Okay. Thank you very much. I gather I'm going back to Stuart Stevenson.
Yeah, I just want to return to other proceedings because I've just been looking at quite long lists that we have as a committee. And there appear to be quite a number of proceedings where convictions remain protected and self-disclosure is not necessary, I think, from B. I mean, just choosing one example, proceedings held in respect of an application for the grant, renewal or cancellation of a licence to be a taxi driver or private hire driver. And I'm just looking to be quite clear that the government is taking the necessary actions to make sure that proceedings of that character, and indeed quite a long list of those that are not ultraviaries, that are within the powers of the government, are going to be absolutely aware, notwithstanding the fact that Schedule B1, which is headed, and I know the heading never has legal force, it's only informative, offences which are to be disclosed subject to rules, that nonetheless that there are protected and self-disclosure is not necessary, that the whole circle is being squared properly in that respect, where the government has the power to do so.
This is something that justice officials have spent considerable time on.
What's the distinction around the different types of proceedings? If you look at, and which don't relate to employment, so doesn't necessarily fall in with the remit of the UK Supreme Court ruling, and also where high-level disclosures are not, don't happen because they're not, an exempted question is not asked. So that's to disapply Section 4.2 of the Rehabilitation Offenders Act. Where the proceedings come in is Section 4.1. So you may say, is it appropriate for the parole board to have limited access to someone's previous convictions? No, no matter how long ago it was. The decision that we come up to and the government agreed, well, no, you need to have that information. If you look at the Scottish Criminal Review Commission, are ready to look whether someone has suffered a miscarriage of justice, there may be reasons to investigate information about someone's previous convictions in order to make an assessment of has a miscarriage of justice happened. The same with if the independent assessor is trying to find out when someone has suffered a miscarriage of justice, the son said, I've never done anything wrong in my life and this is my first conviction and I need £5 million. You've got to look at previous convictions in order to say, well, wait a minute, here, you've had a previous history of things, so therefore the compensation is not right. So there's different processes in terms of proceedings where you've got explosive licence, firearms licence, it's felt that it's appropriate for the full disclosure of that for public safety. Whereas if you've got the Gambling Act, as we said before, then there's other legislation that underpins that. So therefore, there's no point doing that because it's already restricted and protected. Whereas if you look at Schedule 1 proceedings for professions, that's linked into the fact that Schedule 4 of the order allows someone to be asked questions about their spent convictions in order to be part of those professions. But the way the order is drafted, that there won't be treated any differently if they disclose that, just if it's not a protected conviction, if it wouldn't have been disclosed in a higher level disclosure through the appeal court. So there's protections underpinning
so,
that for
so
protection. The proceedings section is particularly complicated because there's certain different because it's not about higher level disclosures because of excluded questions, and there's different reasons for proceedings in there and also the court proceedings as well. So that's what makes this part of this bit of the order
so,
actually complicated and probably why is certain different rules applying, some in, some out, and some protected.
Well, just to be clear then, what if something that did not require to be disclosed emerges during proceedings, it is perfectly proper and indeed required that the conclusions of the proceedings take no account of that information having emerged?
There'd be no, because there's no option for an appeal to the court because the person wouldn't be issued a high-level disclosure by Disclosure Scotland in the first place. In order for them to see what's there, they'd have the only rules that could apply is when it becomes protected. But the tribunal or the proceedings shouldn't take that, you know, can only take things that are not protected into consideration.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right, John, please.
A general question, notwithstanding the differences between Scots law and UK law, are the two lists largely similar if one is, as it were, in the protected category or not? In Scotland, is it largely similar in England, or will people have to be, if they go to apply for a job in England, will it be a different set of rules? And notwithstanding the legal terms, are the lists largely similar?
I mean, obviously, there are different names for different offences.
So there's different rules.
There's different rules in England rules for the Rehabilitation Offenders Act because there are different rehabilitation periods as well. There's a different set of rules. So you've already got a system in terms of when something becomes spent is different in England and Wales and in Scotland. And in terms of how they've constructed their answer to UK Supreme Court ruling, it's different as well. So I haven't checked through every single offence list and how England and Wales have dealt with that, but they've dealt it in a similar way of analysis to say that certain types of convictions we believe should always be disclosed and certain types of convictions that will be protected. In England and Wales, it's protected after 11 years, only if you've got one conviction. If you get another conviction, then nothing's protected and everything's disclosed forever. They do half it for under 18s. So there's complications there. So they've turned around and said, what we think is a proportionate line in the sand. England and Wales have probably gone slightly down that way in terms of if you have more than one conviction, forget it, but it doesn't matter what it is, how serious it is.
For example, a recent case that in the Northern Irish High Court was concerning a lady who had a conviction for carrying a child without a seatbelt in her car. And had that been one child in the back of the car, then the matter would have been not disclosed, but because there was two children in the car, I believe, there was two convictions, and therefore the matter was held on, and the court found that was not a proportionate interference with her human rights. So that filtration system, as it applies south of the border and in Northern Ireland, was developed before the UKSC ruling. The system that ministers are trying to put in place in Scotland is developed fully in awareness of that ruling and subsequent case law, and we believe it's a fair and, you know, decent attempt to try and strike the right balance between these matters.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Stuart?
Now that the matter of different lengths of period of spent has emerged between Scotland and England, and indeed elsewhere, in relation to number 56 in Schedule A, which is corresponding offences elsewhere in England or abroad, which reads an offence under the law of England and Wales or Northern Ireland or any country or territory outside the United Kingdom, which corresponds to an offence listed in the previous 55 articles. Would that require, therefore, disclosure under the periods that are applicable in a non-Scottish jurisdiction rather than the periods? In other words, if it's 11 years in England and it's 58, well, actually England shorter.
If it's unspent, then it'll be disclosed. If it's not spent, then the rules will
apply. So therefore, whether something is spent or not, when the offence is out with Scotland, is determined by the local rules, not by the Scottish rules. Which is it?
Scottish rules apply to offences committed in England, Wales or abroad.
Or
it's a matter of Scots law if you do it in England and Wales.
So therefore, even though something is spent in 11 years in England, it might still be required to be treated.
Not spent, becomes protected after 11 years. We've got 15 years protection for over 18s from date of conviction.
Yeah, yeah.
England and Wales got 11 years from date of. So it's the moment from something. It's the date of conviction is 15 years in Scotland.
Yep.
So if you commit an offence from the rules list in England and Wales and move up to Scotland, it'll be 15 years from a date of conviction.
Even though the offence was in England and the rules would be 11 years.
Residency.
Yes. Yeah,
residency.
That's fine. I'm not seeking to challenge it. I just want to understand it. That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Can we move on then? I think what we've just discussed implies that Scottish citizens might, one, be ignorant as to what the rules you're just bringing in are, and two, be very confused when they talk to a significant number of people who just assume, as they always do, that English law and Scots law are the same. Is the government proposing to bring in some guidance and make it very available on all of this, please?
I mean, we're very alert to the fact that the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act, as it stands, it's legislation from the 70s, is very complex and is very confusing, and that, you know, the situation for citizens as it stands now is not always one that's easy to understand or to navigate. Obviously, with the affirmative order and the compliance order, we've added, if you like, another layer of complexity, and committees commented on that. But we will certainly, you know, following parliamentary process, we'll certainly be updating the Disclosure Scotland website to explain the situation in layman's terms and in plain English, and we will give consideration to, you know, other publications and where that information should be cited. I mean, you know, for example, the Scottish Government website would be, you know, an important place. Individuals seek advice on these matters from a variety of sources. Sometimes they come to MSPs, you know, sometimes they go to the Citizens Advice Bureau, sometimes they'll speak to someone at the job centre, someone, you know, they'll maybe speak to a criminal justice social worker or a lawyer. So I think there are a particular range of stakeholders that we could be targeting and, you know, making people aware that guidance, you know, plain English guidance on all of this will exist. But obviously we need to wait till the end of the 120 days following the compliance order being laid.
Right, can I just challenge that? Because, of course, this is the law from Thursday morning, assuming it works. Can I respectfully suggest that waiting 3 months, 4 months until guidance is issued is probably not terribly helpful to the very large number of people who want to know what happens in between?
Well, I mean, I think we've already heard from committee members that, you know, it's been established that future changes are possible, you know, pending, you know, the 120 days scrutiny. Of course, convener, we'll, you know, consider fully ways to make the situation clear as of Thursday, but it will be a matter that we'll continue to consider as we go forward, because there is, you know, a recognition that the landscape in this area is complex, and it has always been complex, and we would take in good spirit the need to ensure that clear guidance is available.
We've got an amended website ready to go. We've got a significant number of artefacts, frequently asked questions, briefing for staff, lines, etc., all ready for this change. But as the Cabinet Secretary says, that will evolve as the consultation goes forward. We'll need to keep in communication, because I think it's very important that there's a dialogue developed now because of the nature of this, you know, the way that this has come through. And I think that's very much the spirit of how, you know, we'd hope to approach this.
That's good to hear. And of course, we do have the possibility that it won't be a consultation which actually changes Parliament's mind. It might actually be another court case which turns up and actually forces us to change tack, over which, of course, we would have zero control. John Scott, I think, has got a residual question.
Yes. Given the different treatment of this Supreme Court ruling in different parts of the United Kingdom, are all of these different treatments in ECHR compliant? It just seems that there's obviously perhaps more than one way of skinning a cat, which I don't expect is a legal expression. But can all these different treatments, which appear to put into practice what requires to be done, are they all equally good in terms of ECHR compliance?
Of course, ultimately, that's for the courts to decide on. The starting point for all of us is that we do have a different legal system in Scotland than the one in England and Wales, and that's just a statement of fact. I'm not giving any opinion, you know, attached with that. But given, I suppose, some of the ongoing issues that colleagues elsewhere in the UK, you know, are tackling with, I think, I believe strongly that the Scottish Government was very judicious in waiting until after the Supreme Court judgment and following case law and taking a little bit of time to see how things unfolded before coming to Parliament with our solution.
Thanks very much. I wasn't trying to catch you out, I was just trying to reassure myself. And finally, I would like to ask, given a remedial order is modified in the way which also affects the disclosure by individuals of their convictions following the process of parliamentary scrutiny and stakeholder engagement, it's likely a further affirmative order under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act will be laid in Parliament to incorporate similar charges as discussed. What would be the process in that instance, in this instance? Would it require a further instrument being afforded an expedited process? And what would be the implications for disclosures made under the draft order being considered today?
I mean, certainly in terms of the theoretical possibility, it is indeed a possibility that we return to Parliament with another affirmative order, depending on you know, the views and the issues that are raised in the post-legislative scrutiny of the compliance order. It is, of course, difficult, you know, for me to sit here and now and predict the issues that may or may not be raised in that process. But I mean, and I'll you know, hand over to officials in a moment who will give you a more technical response, but given the two issues that I've outlined why through necessity we've had to do an expedited process, one being the disruption. If you change the system, that is disruptive to Disclosure Scotland, and it is having to cease operation while we go through that process. So in my mind, that would necessitate an expedited process of some description. And if you are in the process of moving from one refinement to the other, there needs to be public confidence in the decisions that are actually being made. And it is difficult to achieve public confidence and be making the decisions when you are going from one system to a more refined system. So my instinct would be that should we need to lay another affirmative offer, and I appreciate from a parliamentary point of view it's unsatisfactory, but should we be in that position, we may well be looking at another expedited process. Do the officials have anything to add to that?
I don't think so. I mean, we have to, we'll take into account later on what observations are made and then take a view on whether there's to be any changes to the remedial order. And the remedial order covers other things than the draft affirmative order covers in relation to particularly around the disclosure and the way the appeal process operates for both the Police Act and the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Act. So there could be changes in there that then don't need to be reflected in the affirmative order.
In general terms, it would seem to me that if we need another order, given that this one has been expedited, and we need another affirmative instrument, which is to be also expedited, it appears a bit ungainly, I can put it no more elegantly, in terms of parliamentary process.
The second
and it
remedial
would not
order
be something I would think that we would necessarily welcome in Parliament in the general sense.
Well, hoping for Mr. Scott is that there is confidence in the proposal that we're putting forward to Parliament. It would just be very foolish of me to rule out that stakeholders and parliamentarians may raise matters that do indeed need to be considered. So we can't at this stage rule out another affirmative order. Although I am told any second affirmative order wouldn't be expedited. So,
on the basis
that's
of
the
precisely
point
the justification for why you're here now, you would expect the same rules to apply. I think I think we'd be in the same place there. Thank you.
So sorry about going round the houses in that
one. No, it's okay. Yes, let's just come back there. What would be... What is your view of what the implications would be for disclosures made during the interim? Because we have to change this in 128 days' time. Then we've got the law as you're currently proposing it implemented for 128 days. Presumably those are valid in their own terms.
So any disclosures that are issued under the law as it applies from Thursday until the second, if a second remedial order is made, they would be valid under that law.
Yep. And it is perhaps just worth making the point that our job is not to decide, and indeed Parliament's job is not to decide whether the order before us is the one that we personally would have drawn up, or whether we would all individually agree to every single line on every list. The issue before us, I would suggest, is whether or not this is capable of being ECHR compliant, recognising there will be more than one way of dealing with that. And that's the evidence that we've been trying to get this morning. I think we've reached the end of our list, as it were, and I'm looking at colleagues just to make sure that's the case. There are a few things that I'd like to pick up on, please. The first is, I'm just wondering whether Gerry Hart could go back to the point you made about more than one conviction appearing at the same time, and whether that would mean that a protected offence conviction would actually necessarily have to be disclosed with others that came at the same time, which are not protected.
I mean, each offence has to be considered separately, but I mean, Gerry, I'll run through the process, convener.
Yes, the decision has been taken that where that is the case, where a conviction which is being disclosed, a spent conviction which is being disclosed, occurs as part of, you know, a concatenated, you know, body of text with other matters on the same diet,
yep,
then the process will be that those matters will be disclosed. However, it's worth pointing out that the way that we've done this, every conviction which is spent is processed as if it were the only one. So, you know, there's a very proportionate inception process. It doesn't group everything together in a pattern. It takes everything in its own merits. So that's a, you know, issue of disclosing the matters around that is offset by the fact that everything is being processed separately. They're not directly correlated, but there is a link in that process.
And that would be on the basis that the protectable convictions are nonetheless part of the narrative of the unprotectable one.
That's the policy intention, that we believe that by disclosing the matters around that, it gives the person a context around the matter which is, you know, the central concern in that instance, and that's fair and proportionate.
And then in that context, it's a fair and proportionate use of information which you would nonetheless accept is potentially private.
Indeed.
Yes. Okay. I'm wondering whether if I could return to the issue as I'd understood it said, and forgive me, I could have looked this up. I think it's always been said that the age of the offender is at the time of the offence, but the time is since conviction, and I'm just wondering if we could explain.
It's the age of the offender at conviction, not the time of the offence, at conviction.
Date of conviction.
That's how it works under the Rehabilitation Offenders Act. So it's the same consistent approach.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. That's fine. Okay, I mean, that's at least a justification, and that's on the record. Thank you very much.
Doesn't always contain the age of the offender at the age of the offence.
Yeah, I'm with you there. Could I just ask about, just really to put it on the record, my understanding of your 10-day period when information has been disclosed to the applicant but not to the potential employer, if I might use those terms, that is, if essentially, as I understand it, the Scottish Government's defence to disclosing private information. It's actually given the applicant a 10 days' notice that this information will be disclosed unless they otherwise say that they're going to appeal it. Is it as simple as that?
Yes.
What justification, as a matter of law, does the Government have for taking that view, please? I'm not saying it's unreasonable, but can you...
The order provides that justification in terms of the Rehabilitation Offence Act says, Section 4,
yep,
once it's spent, you don't disclose it. However, Parliament turned around and said the 2013 order allows that extended period of disclosure for certain types of employment and professions. So it's a consistent approach. It's about at what point do you draw that line, and we've obviously thought 15 years, but there may be some instances where somebody's done something that the Sheriff Court can do that. So that it's...
Yeah, sorry, that's defence for the 15 years. I was specifically concerned about the 10 working day delay. Is there any statutory precedent for that? I'm not saying it's wrong.
Do you mean why 10 days as opposed to 12 days or 8 days?
I'm just wondering, is there any legal precedent for that? Mm-hmm. So I'm not arguing it's unreasonable. Mm-hmm. It does actually seem very reasonable and proportionate. I'm just wondering whether there's anything else.
There's not any particular legal precedent on which it's based. No. It's simply trying to strike a balance between the giving the individual a chance to consider the information and whether they want to use the opportunity to appeal, and also not prejudicing them particularly by leaving a longer period in which an employer is left without a disclosure. So it's trying to strike a balance as to what's reasonable and what is a reasonable period of time in which to for them to make a decision as to what to do.
Yeah.
Okay. It's a policy decision.
Fine. Thank you very much. I think at that point we have
finished. Thank you very much for your patience, your very lucid explanation, and forgive us if to start off with we've got some things wrong. I think that's manifest from the record, but I think we've now in the right place. So that gives me opportunity to close this particular item and move this committee meeting into private.